Good morning. I am Senator Jamal T. Bailey, the chair of the Senate Standing Committee on Codes. I'm very excited to be chairing this hearing this morning about the Clean Slate Bill. I'm joined today by the co-host of this hearing, the Senate Standing Committee on Elections Chair Senator Zelnor Myrie, and also the prime sponsor of the Clean Slate legislation. We are joined by a number of other senators, Senator Julia Salazar, Senator Anthony Palumbo, Senator Jabari Brisport, Senator Tom O'Mara, and we will be joined by other members as the hearing proceeds, and we are grateful for their appearance today. Again, this bill is about a hearing on S-1553A, which is an act to amend the criminal procedure law and executive law and correction law in relation to the automatic expungement of certain convictions, which is commonly and colloquially known as the Clean Slate Act. We're holding this hearing in order to elicit testimony and discuss the contents of this bill and to solicit comments from stakeholders in the impacted community, as well as those in the law enforcement and criminal justice community and the community at large. We've reviewed the testimony submitted by the witnesses prior to this hearing, and we expect a robust and respectful hearing today on 1553 and its goals. This hearing is being live streamed on the Senate's website. I'd like to remind the witnesses from the outset that they have 5 minutes to make their remarks. We must be mindful of the time allotted, given the number of witnesses who wish to testify and the nature of the testimony and the subsequent questions which the members of this legislature will be asking. With that being said, I'd like to introduce again the Senate Standing Committee on Elections Chair, Senator Zelnor Myrie, and the sponsor of the bill for a brief statement. We've also been recently joined by Senator Todd Kaminsky. Senator Myrie.
Thank you, Senator Bailey. And let me sort of publicly express my gratitude for your leadership and for insisting that we hold this hearing on such an important issue. I'm proud to be the sponsor of this bill, but this is an issue that affects the entire state of New York. It is 2.3 million New Yorkers who have conviction records and who have to live with this and deal with the repercussions of having a record every single day. The beauty of this bill, I believe, is that it not only stands for basic tenets of redemption and fairness and justice, but will also be a tool for public safety and economic prosperity. I don't think we can have an honest dispute that over the past couple of decades, New York has over-policed and mass-incarcerated communities of color. And that's why out of that 2.3 million, 80% are Black and Latinx. So this bill would be a step forward in making up for what we have done in our criminal legal system here in New York. But it's also a tool for public safety. In other jurisdictions that have utilized expungement, studies have shown that the recidivism rates drastically reduce for individuals who have their convictions sealed and expunged. And in some instances, like in Michigan, the recidivism rate is actually lower than the general population crime rate. It is also an incentive. If you know that your convictions will be sealed and expunged, if you do not commit an offense for a number of years, that incentivizes you to not commit an offense and to continue to keep the public safe. And it's also a tool for economic prosperity. We know that individuals with convictions lose hundreds of thousands of dollars throughout their lifetime simply because they are denied on their conviction record. This is about a recovery for everybody here in the state of New York. We leave billions of dollars on the table because we shut people out of our economy. So again, I am proud to sponsor this bill. I really look forward to having a robust discussion. I'm grateful to all of my colleagues who have joined us today and who will be joining. And again, thank the chair of the Codes Committee for leading us in this hearing today.
Thank you, Senator Myrie. So this hearing will be conducted in a series of six panels. Panels vary in the amounts of members that they have, but the first panel is a three-person panel, and we're going to introduce them now. Michael Zaki Smith, a policy entrepreneur and activist from Next 100. Melinda Agnew, a community leader for Center for Community Alternatives, and Cedric Fulton, a community organizer and civil rights manager for the Hudson Catskill Housing Coalition. Panelists, please be reminded that you do have 5 minutes, and we will begin with Mr. Smith. Mr. Smith, thank you for coming today. You are on the clock.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate you all having me. Thank you all, senators. Again, good morning. when I was released from prison in 2004, I knew that I would never return. I was focused and I knew exactly what I was going to do with my life, and that was be in the service of young people. It was very clear to me that my passion and my purpose was to be a voice to help young people step into their power and to help them navigate through many of the obstacles they face. I know firsthand about those obstacles. I'm a survivor of under-resourced, over-policed, and over-prosecuted Bed-Stuy, Brooklyn at the introduction of the crack era and mass incarceration. I'm a survivor of New York State's violent response to the pain and suffering of communities of color. There was no voice or example to help me navigate through those times. I knew that I would contribute powerfully to my community by building its young people. Upon release, I hit the ground running, finding spaces that would benefit from my story and what I had to offer as guidance for young people. In hindsight, I was subsequently worried about the people who would judge me for my past and not see me as a whole person. But I didn't think about it too much until December 8th, 2017, a day I would never forget. I had been working at a high school for a nonprofit organization, contributing powerfully to not only the school, but to the community at large for about 4.5 years. Several weeks earlier, I was fingerprinted so the nonprofit could stay in compliance with contractual agreements. My past wasn't a secret to anyone. Everyone knew of my past. It actually was a benefit to the school based on the population and the circumstances young people were navigating. I was a credible messenger. On December 8th, 2017, as I headed towards the door of my home to leave for work, I realized I had a letter from the fingerprint unit. I opened the letter and it said the following: pursuant to the above cited statute, you are permanently disqualified from school employment, services as a volunteer, school board member, or trustee of a charter school with any education institution under the Department of Education, or employment with a contracted service provider under contract with said school or educational facility. You have 14 days from the date of this written notice notice of disqualification to challenge the accuracy of your criminal record. I was confused at first. I thought there would be an opportunity for me to demonstrate what I have done since being released from prison, how I have impacted the lives of young people and communities throughout the country, but there was no such opportunity. All they saw was my record. At that moment, at that very moment, I realized that I was serving a life sentence. I was given a silent life sentence of perpetual punishment. For the first time in my life, I questioned the discrimination and how this absolutely does not make sense. I thought this is counterproductive to the safety of our communities. This is counterproductive to a person's ability to move beyond their past. This is counterproductive to rehabilitation, to have a person serve their time, do all the things required in the sentence imposed, and then have them punished for the rest of their lives. This isn't practical. It serves no one other than the revolving door of the prison industrial complex. It isn't accountability. This isn't accountability. This is punishment. Punishment only serves the person administering it. With accountability, everyone is restored, the person who has committed the crime and those who are harmed by it. It is possible that if December 8th hadn't happened, I would still be working with young people in the capacity that I was. I would have still been oblivious to the terminology of collateral consequences. I would still be oblivious to the fact that according to the United States Commission on Civil Rights, there are over 44,000 laws and barriers that hinder the lives of anyone with a criminal record. I would not have known that there were 2.3 million human beings in the state of New York with a criminal record. the most what's most disturbing from 1990 to 2019, 80% of New York State's population was Black and Latino, and 75% of that population came from seven neighborhoods in New York City. This is a bill that can restore some of the harm that our current system has imposed upon communities of color. This is a huge step to what racial justice can look like in the state of New York. Clean slate is long overdue. We can end perpetual punishment in New York, because after we have served our time, what other debt do we owe?
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Smith, for your testimony. Our next panelist will be Melinda Agnew. Ms. Agnew, you're on the clock.
Good morning, everybody that makes up this call. My name is Melinda Agnew. And in 1997, I was convicted of a misdemeanor, aggravated assault, and it was a gun charge, and they dropped it down to a weapons charge. I since then completed my my conditions of probation. I even went into a women's halfway house facility. That's where my counseling and stuff began. Throughout the years, I became a mom, and I also went back to school. I went back to school. I earned my bachelor's degree in community human services, and I'm working now on my master's degree. And I just believe that throughout this time, it has been very hard for me to just reach up the ladder in employment. I've been denied a lot of jobs because of my criminal background. Even I've been denied a lot of housing throughout the years because of my criminal background. And when I found out about the Clean Slate Act, you know, it holds important to me, because not only am I suffering, I've noticed a lot of people in my community who went back to school who had a criminal background, but they can't move ahead because that their record is still holding them back. You know, I know a young lady who just graduated from nursing who's having a hard time getting her nursing's license because of her criminal background. And this has been, she's been out of trouble for years. So I just believe that through education, through giving back to my community, being a role model, you know, I've done my sentence, I've done my time. You know, I would just like for New York State to acknowledge that by giving myself and many others like me a clean slate to be a productive member of society. You know, I believe that role models are made out through their experiences. And how can we teach our younger generation, you know, how to be conductive and productive in their life, you know, if we cannot allow that opportunity? And I just, you know, and I'm urging lawmakers to really consider passing this Clean Slate Act bill. It'll just, you know, it would empower New York even more than what we are. And I just want to thank you guys for the time, for listening to me. And that's all.
Thank you, Ms. Agnew. The next person to submit to give testimony will be Mr. Cedric Fulton. Mr. Fulton, you're on the clock.
Good morning. First of all, I would like to say that I'm humbled, and I'm so grateful that Melinda and Zaki gave their testimony and shared, you know, very impactful stories. But let me move on. Good morning. My name is Cedric Fulton. I'm a community organizer, and I'm a civil rights manager for the Hudson Catskill Housing Coalition, where my work involves empowering public housing and low-income tenants to fight for housing justice. HCHC is also a member of the Clean Slate Campaign Steering Committee, and as a part of our fight for access to stable housing. I would like to thank Senators Bailey and Myrie and the members of the Senate Standing Committee on Codes for holding today's important hearing, a hearing that many of us here in New York are personally invested in, incomparable to any remedy deemed worthy of our pursuit of dignity. At the risk of sounding redundant, something us organizers dive headfirst into, we are all well aware of the 2.3 million New Yorkers that face the perpetual punishment of a past criminal conviction. I would love to share my personal story, I think it would be very empowering for me in this time of anxiety and strife. However, I think I'm going to take this time to share a story that put a face to the number 2.3 million. The 2.3 million faces connected by a shared trauma. Through my work, I met a young woman of 26 years living in Troy, New York. Born to a mother that rose above her class to become a New York City police officer, a grandmother who almost single-handedly saved the small city's youth, this young woman decided to honor her family's legacy by giving back to her community, the community that she has now adopted as her own, a place where she has decided to raise her now 5 and 4-year-old daughters. She's volunteering her time in at local food pantries and marching against gun violence, even taking the time to take online courses.
You're muted, Cedric. You muted your mic.
So Fulton, you're muted. You've been muted for about 10 seconds.
I'm sorry about that. This young woman has volunteered at her time at local food pantries and marching against gun violence, and even taking the time to take online courses for victims' advocacy. She was recognized at dinners and began to get offers of employment. Yet, when she finally applied for the very positions that were offered while volunteering her time, she was turned down repeatedly due to 2 misdemeanor drug convictions that she was pressured into taking at the age of 17 and 18 by a DA that already had a plea deal accepted by her then boyfriend, who admitted to possessing the drugs seized in a drug raid. Astonishingly, after 6 years of being turned down for position after position, she has still decided to fight for her city's youth and young mothers, all as a volunteer, relying on the Department of Social Services to provide for her and her children. How much longer does this hero have to suffer a life sentence due to her permanent record? This is one of the many horror stories that I hear crisscrossing this beautiful state of ours, and this is your opportunity to provide a second chance for the people that you proudly serve. We thank you for your consideration on this bill. We and our Clean Slate partners look forward to working with your committee and the rest of the Senate membership to bring this important legislation to New York. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fulton. At this point, I would like to begin with Senator Myrie to see if there are any questions for the members of the first panel. Senator Myrie.
Thank you, Senator Bailey, and thank you to everyone who testified and for sharing your stories. I know that's not an easy thing to do, and we appreciate that you've used your own life experiences to try to better the status for the rest of New York. I just ask one very brief question. You know, we have heard the term perpetual punishment used, and I'm wondering if any of the panelists, if you can speak to what does that mean for either you or folks in your community on a day-to-day basis, having to live with a conviction record and what those implications are. What does that mean for you day to day?
Yeah, so what it means for me day to day, as you see the artwork in the back, you know, it was very a thing that I realized after, you know, losing my job, was that this is something that is never ending. That's what a perpetual punishment, it is never ending, it is continuous. And not only the fact that if I apply for a job or apply for housing or apply for school, that I'll be denied or that I would have to relive, like as if I was going to court all over again, right? And someone just gets the opportunity to judge me as if this thing is occurring right now, as if I'm that person. And I actually begin to feel that, right? Sitting in that, like feeling very shameful, right? And even just avoiding spaces, right? Trying to navigate and get under and hide and try to get around that type of, like, just living that kind of life. And I'm free. Right? I'm not in prison. Like, I'm free. This is long past. So why, you know, do I have to experience this continuously? So that's what perpetual punishment is for me.
Yeah, and for myself, again, I would love to speak about myself and what that perpetual punishment looks like. However, it just brings me back to a young family in Hudson, New York, you know, that I just talked to the other day, that we have this young man that for 18 months was parenting his six children, one of them disabled, from across the street of the housing complex that his wife and his family lived in, based on his past criminal conviction. This young man hasn't had a criminal conviction in 15 years. In 15 years, yet he has to, because of the zero tolerance policies, you know, in this state and when in public housing, this individual, just because he was accused, he has subsequently beat the charge. However, for 18 months, he parented his child and his children from across the street. That's a problem. That's a problem. We're about with this New York State. We have a Celsius on our flag, which means ever higher, ever upward, right? We should be the first. We should be the leading. And this is not a criminal justice bill. This is a housing justice bill and an economic justice bill. And I just wanted to bring to mind that young family down in Hudson that I spoke with the other day.
For me, perpetual punishment is the act of being convicted of something that you're convicted for repeatedly over and over again. You made a mistake, you realized your mistake, and you paid for the consequences of that mistake to come back out in society and to do good, to give back, to be a role model, to still have that stink of what you've done in the past. And like I said, you know, we're all humans. We all prone to make mistakes. But when you learn from your mistakes, why are we still being held responsible for something that happened for so long? And in my case, 22 years. 22 years, I'm still, you know, I have to tell my story, you know, of what happened, or you understand that I didn't get this raise because of what happened. So to me, that's what perpetual punishment is. Continuously being punished for something that you've done and that you rectified you rehabilitated yourself and you want to do better, but society's saying you can't. Nope, we're going to still hold this over you.
Thank you, panelists, and thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Myrie. I have a question, but I just want to recognize that we've been joined by Senator Gallivan and Senator Kavanaugh since then. But actually, I'll defer to the ranking member of the committee, Senator Anthony Palumbo. Senator Palumbo.
Thank you, Chairman. And good morning, panel. How are you?
Good morning. Good morning.
And now, I have actually, in my previous life, I have been on both sides of representing individuals on both sides of the criminal justice system. I was a defense attorney. I was a prosecutor in a major crime bureau for many years. So I just want to get your take that it seems as though, I mean, your stories are very compelling. I mean, without even knowing what the underlying charges were, other than what Melinda mentioned, that you folks have made a tremendous effort to rehabilitate yourselves, get into society, and this is kind of this albatross hanging over your head and over your neck, around your neck for many, many years. Do you feel that there should be any types of crimes that should be excluded, possibly from the expungement side of this bill? Because this bill, Clean Slate, has two aspects, right? There's a ceiling to the general public, and then ultimately an expungement as if it never happened. So can you just give some comments in that regard to us?
The position the position is that everyone should have a road to expungement. People are redeemable, right? There should be an opportunity for relief for everyone, right? Again, we need to address the whole person. We're not addressing the whole person. We're just looking at the actual act as if that is all that person is made up, and that circumstances and environmental and all mental health and all of the other things that exist in our community, specifically in communities of color, we have to look at the whole picture. And everyone, again, people are redeemable, period.
And that's a good point, Mr. Smith. And just to follow up on that, if I may, that you folks have been clearly committed to rehabilitation. And I think we can agree as well that You know, some people are not. So how would you feel about potentially allowing some sort of a review system, for example? Like you would go back to the sentencing judge and say, "Judge, you can expunge this for me because I have done so much." As Melinda said, 22 years, staying out of trouble, doing the right thing. And it's certainly someone who would warrant relief from that conviction. But then there are other people that are not so committed. As we've seen, and as I said, I've seen in the 20-something years of practice in law that some folks aren't. So do you think that there should be some kind of a balancing test there where, you know, those folks that are really trying, like yourselves on the panel, who are doing amazing things, you know, versus other people who aren't? Can you comment? And I'll allow all of you to speak. I'm sorry, I cut you off because I'm running out of time. But please tell me, I'd like to hear what you have to say about that.
Yeah, I think we need to investigate I'm sorry. Go ahead, Melinda.
No, you go ahead. Go ahead, Zakai.
Yeah, I again, we need to just think a look and look at the circumstances and why individuals are not rehabilitating, looking at the fact that drug addiction plays a part. Economics, people are doing crimes of survival, right? This is just, people are not just criminals, right? There are factors that exist that the system just absolutely does not look into. And then the fact to have someone else to come, for me to come back to court and stand before a judge again and have someone review it and go through trial all over again and have a district attorney come in. These are civil matters. These are not criminal matters. We weren't actually sentenced to this punishment. We were sentenced to prison time, right? And we have served it. We have completed what we were actually sentenced to. And so it just seems to have no grounds for anyone else to come in. Our parole ended with no issue. Right, our time ended, no issue, right? Like, why does this have to now be reviewed after we have served everything? But for what? It's just that not practical, and it isn't fair, actually.
Okay, thank you. And so basically, there should be unlimited chances for this, or do you think at some point that if someone continues to get rearrested or commit additional crimes, that at some point they lose that opportunity to get the benefit of a program such as this?
Senator, I have two children behind me that's in a picture behind me. I have two children that I had full legal residential custody of since 2012, the day that I walked home from prison, the day that I walked out of prison. And I'm somebody, again, my children will be 12 and 13 on September 12th. And just the joy that I'm having every single day in my life, watching them grow and having hand in their development, right? You ask my children, did I deserve a second, third, and fourth chance, right? I actually went to prison in New York State four times and did a total of 11 years in New York State. And I came home, and for the last eight years, I have dedicated myself to my children. This is not an anomaly. I'm not somebody that's just, you know, that should be, you know, waving this flag. And no, I am one of many that does this, right? So you can pose that question to my children. Do I deserve these repeated chances? Sometimes it takes these repeated chances and the belief that people are fighting for us to give us that clean slate, to give us a pathway to our healing.
Thank you, Senator Palumbo, and thank you, Mr. Fulton, Mr. and Mr. Smith, and Ms. Agnew. Want to also note that we've been joined by Senator Alessandra Biaggi as well. Seeing no other questions, I'm going to, I guess, ask a question. Well, make a comment and I guess ask one further question. It's important to note that in our justice system has been changed, especially over the last 3 years. But we've looked at things differently. We've looked at what crimes are. And previously, what was happening, we were criminalizing poverty and we were criminalizing addiction and we were criminalizing substance abuse. So the point where individuals, especially in the neighborhood that I reside from, would have committed multiple offenses in relation to crimes of survival to it, would be something that we weren't treating, because we weren't treating substance use disorder, we were criminalizing it. And so a lot of the crimes that would be what we're looking at expunging now would be things that maybe we treat differently going forward. I think that's an important distinction to note about the way that we're looking, regardless of what side you sit on, the way that we're treating crime and punishment, and the way that we should be looking to treat crime and punishment going forward. I think that's an important distinction to make, as well as the nature of certain offenses, and that everything would not be expungible. Certain offenses, and Senator Myrie is much more well equipped to handle this than I am, but certain offenses that carry a life sentence certainly would not be eligible for the expungement, from my understanding. And there are certain things that we can get into the technical perspective. But I just wanted to ask Mr. Fulton, Ms. Agnew, Mr. Smith, either one of you, each of you have made it out. Each of you you're speaking that truth to power. How many individuals that you run into on a daily basis, are there individuals that you run into on a daily basis that don't have the fortitude that are within the same, that are in that same position?
I'm going to speak to your question, Senator, and I wanted to speak to the other senator. I believe his name is Palumbo. I apologize if I mispronounced his name. But yes, when I even addressed it, when I was talking about mines, I even addressed another young lady. It's many individuals, and especially Black and brown individuals, that is imposed by this bill, and if this bill will help them and enable them to be productive members of society, will be enable them to be mothers and fathers, and enable them to be powerful mentors in our community. Now, to go back to the previous question before you, Senator, but correct me if I'm wrong. It was like, would this bill continuously allow for repeated offenders? Okay, that question one is answered in a couple ways. And Senator, I think you hit on that. When a lot of our crimes have been, people have been criminalized for things that, like substance abuse. So they weren't getting treatment. However, when they commit a crime, and especially if they are on probation or parole, they finish their sentence. So when they finish their sentence, they should be allowed another chance. However, if that person is, if it's under, and it should be automatically, because I feel that the Justice Center, they have the individual's record. So they understand what that crime was. Now, any other serious offense where they're continuously being monitored? No, that bill does not qualify for them. But for those individuals that are trying, and believe me, sometimes it takes us a couple times to fall down. But if we finish our crime and we're done with our sentence in society, and you guys and the law justice system say you're done, you're off probation, you're off parole, you should then be given another chance to re-enter society as an individual, as a productive member of society.
And to answer your question, Senator, I do believe, and thank you for that, Melinda. And you know, definitely, there's on an everyday basis, and doing this work and knocking on doors and talking to individuals. Clean slate is the buzzword right now. Clean slate, right? And the opportunity that people are getting a sense that they're going to have an opportunity, right, to get their life back in order on a pathway to healing. I'm going to continue to say that. On our pathway to healing. And that's why I'm here. I'm here to testify today for the many individuals that didn't have the capacity to get here and testify right now. However, they are out there still trying and plugging away to be a productive member of society.
Yeah, to respond, we were doing an interview. We were just talking to some individuals around the bill or what have you. And there was the question was, Do you even think that this is possible, that this can actually happen, right? We've been so conditioned, right, to buy into a lot of the fear mongering that exists that we don't even try to imagine what else is possible outside of what exists now. So listening to our people, like this really could happen. Like this is the thing that we're, you know, experiencing. This is where our community, they're totally oblivious to what is going on. They're just feeling the impact of everything. So when something like this is presented, it's like, what? Really? Is this possible? Because what has led the conversation has not been anything that is productive or that will assist and restore our impacted communities. We need this. We need this. We need this.
Thank you all very much for your testimony. I see no further questions from my fellow colleagues. So at this point, I'd really once again like to thank you for your courage. Thank you for your words and for your testimony. And thank you for appearing before us today. And I hope you have a pleasant day. Thank you very much.
Thank
be blessed.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
The next panel will be a panel of district attorneys. Albany District Attorney P. David Soares, Putnam County District Attorney Robert V. Tendy, Bronx County DA Darcel Denise Clark, Richmond County DA Michael E. McMahon, and Rensselaer County DA Mary Pat Donnelly. This panel will be coming on shortly. And I'd like to thank our district attorneys for the work that they do and for appearing before us today. I think we have everyone. And I think that we're going to start with Bronx County District Attorney Darcel Clark, DA Clark.
Actually, good morning, Senator, and to all the senators. Actually, I'm going to defer to my colleague to the North, Albany District Attorney David Soares, and then my colleague DA Robert Tendy, and then I will be speaking last. DA McMahon and Pat Donnelly are also here, as other members of the DA community are here, and for support, and you know, be here to answer any questions that you all may have. But that is the order that we plan to present to you today.
Thank you, Madam DA. DA Soares, you are on the clock.
Senator Bailey, first and foremost, I want to thank you, and certainly thank you, Senator Miley, for the opportunity to present just a little bit of background. The wonderful and amazing DA from the Bronx has deferred to me to go first, because I'm originally from Rhode Island, Red Sox, and we currently are first in the AL. So there's a little bit of background there. I wanted to clear that up. I would also be remiss if I didn't just say this. You know, your people in the first panel, Melinda in particular, Cedric and Mr. Smith, very, very compelling experiences. They're sharing with us, giving so much of their own personal background, and I found their testimony very moving. And it's one of the reasons why we've been doing Clean Slate in Albany County for as long as we have. But I would just offer Melinda just one piece of advice: provide testimony in a parked vehicle and not one that is moving. But be that as it may, I just wanted to say that since becoming DA, I've worked hard to push the entire criminal justice system to deliver better results for our community and to ensure that our work reflects our shared values, no matter who the victims or perpetrators are in any given case. This is especially important for our vulnerable communities and cities throughout the state. The communities that experience complex, multidimensional issues, not only for prosecuting crimes, but for reintegrating those prosecuted back into society after their time has been served. These challenges cannot simply be legislated away. However, when the opportunity arises for legislation to assist and even transform the lives of others, there is a moral and ethical imperative to do so. In my humble estimation, the most significant criminal justice legislation passed in the state in the last decade occurred a few sessions ago when Raise the Age was passed in 2017. Although much of the focus of the bill and discussions involved procedure and venue for 16 and 17-year-olds, the most significant and impactful portion of the bill was the ceiling provision in 160.59. 165.59 was important because it managed to provide people with relief, the relief of sealing. Prosecutors weighed in and endorsed the passage of this measure because it addressed our primary concern, and that was avoiding impediments to using prior criminal convictions in cases of reoffense. Many of us provided testimony, information in support of 160.59. The law was passed, and it accomplished part of a very noble goal, giving people a second chance. Now, when 160.59 was under consideration, the eligible and ineligible offenses were intensely scrutinized. And overall, I believe the categories to be appropriate. Although there are some exceptions, most felonies are eligible for sealing, and only six misdemeanors, all of them sex crimes, are ineligible. Today, this provision has helped to bring relief to 2,498 New Yorkers. And in a state with close to 19 million people, I think we can do better. In fact, I know that we can do better. The current remedies contained in CPL 160.59, as well as Article 440, the motions to vacate judgment, which are the primary tools that we are currently using to seal and expunge, are not without its problems and limitations. We can all agree that 160.59 is too rigid because it only allows for the sealing of up to two criminal convictions, one qualifying felony and one qualifying misdemeanor, or two qualifying misdemeanors. As we know, when an applicant seeks sealing of a criminal conviction, the two-step analysis must be undertaken. First, one must consider the eligibility of the applicant. To be eligible, the applicant's last prior conviction from release of custody must have occurred at least 10 years prior to the application. Second, the conviction sought must be sealed themselves. They must be eligible offenses. Sex and violent crimes, for example, cannot be sealed. I want to now briefly explain to you our experience here in Albany County to illustrate some of the shortcomings with the current remedies, while also highlighting some opportunities provided by CPL 440 that we can use to build on as we continue to move forward in this pursuit. First, in Albany County, that we have found that one felony, one misdemeanor, or two misdemeanor restrictions places serious limitations on sealing. The inflexibility of this provision has prevented many reformed and rehabilitated men and women from receiving the benefit of sealing. For the ambitious who may have committed three or more low-level misdemeanors, sealing would be denied under this too rigid conviction rule, even though these offenses would otherwise qualify for sealings. The best examples that we've seen are examples where individuals in their youth are engaging in back and forth behavior with other individuals. These events that occurred 10 years ago, 5 years ago, 6 years ago, but clearly through track record, these individuals have now outgrown that phase. But yet, under the current guidelines, these individuals are prevented from getting relief. To overcome this hurdle in Albany, we have used the CPL 440 motion to vacate judgment to expunge the third plus misdemeanors in order to clear way for the applicant to qualify and apply for sealing under the current provision. But CPL 440 is not well suited for that purpose, and the current as it's currently written, and it can be a complicated process. So one of my recommendations, if it were to be accepted, was to amend CPL 440 to expand the interest of justice portion of the statute. And these are among the things that I think the legislature can do in order to provide judges with greater opportunity for sealing. Second,
yes, sir. You're about a minute over the time, and I just want to be respectful and give you 30 more seconds to wrap up so we can get to the rest of your colleagues. I don't want to cut you off right in the middle.
Sure. In closing, let me just say this. I think that what we have is an issue of qualifying offenses and individuals who qualify. Thus far, I think we got the qualifying offenses correct. Violent criminals, sex offenders are people that I don't believe should qualify for expungement or sealing. However, I do believe that we need to open the opportunity more for individuals who are denied simply because of the number of offenses that they've committed. I agree with you. People who have experienced addiction, people who are living a certain lifestyle that we can also, you know, attribute to immaturity, those are individuals that right now cannot obtain the benefit of saline expungement. And those are the individuals, like many of the people that just testified before us, that I believe clearly should be entitled to expungement and saline. And with that, I'll turn over. I appreciate the extra time.
Thank you, DA. And again, I for the record, I'm a Met fan. So the Boston Red Sox commentary that you made did not affect your time being cut off, much to the chagrin of my DA, who tells me all the time about my what she believes is my poor choice in Mets. But let's go Mets, and let's go DA Robert Tendy. You are now on the clock.
Thank you very much, Senator Bailey. If a Mets fan can represent the Bronx, then there's hope for mankind. I want to say that Melinda, Cedric, and Zakai, their testimony was very, very powerful, very compelling, and it's great to see a human being have their face put on the discussion regarding a bill. I really, really enjoyed that, and I applaud them. I hope nobody here would be surprised that district attorneys throughout New York State are, for the most part, fully supportive of the sentiments expressed in this proposed bill. I know I am, and every district attorney I've talked to feels pretty much the same way, with some realistic reservations. The goal of making it easier to give a fresh start, a clean slate to someone who deserves it, is admirable and will help make a former criminal a better citizen. I also want you to know that because we agree with the sentiments expressed in the proposed bill, the Senate has available to it a tremendously powerful tool to assist in crafting legislation that will make these sentiments a reality and that will also protect the citizens of our state. And that powerful tool is the District Attorneys Association of New York State. We really can help you make this legislation something that everyone can support, that will take into account the numerous issues that need to be addressed and that can be addressed if you let us work with you. The intentions of the law are very good, but the law is very general. And so it does not take into account many important exceptions that need to be addressed or at least discussed in order to safeguard our citizens, particularly our most vulnerable citizens. And by the way, that also includes our citizens who have committed crimes and have indeed paid their debt to society. So by way of example, these are just a few of the many issues that need to be addressed. Senior healthcare workers. Those of us who have elderly parents or grandparents need to know that the person they are hiring to live part-time or full-time with their loved ones do not have various criminal convictions: theft, assault, animal abuse, forgery, identity theft, fraudulent conveyances, and others. I get a number of these cases, and my question is always, and they're sad, they're heartbreaking. And my question is always, why didn't the families do a better background check on these people? Under the current law, it would make that impossible. This is something that affects me personally. Other workers in the healthcare industry, nursing homes, homes for the mentally infirm, school bus drivers, public transportation drivers, railroad engineers, subway conductors. Not only is their background extremely important, but failure to discover a problematic driver could lead to massive lawsuits against public utilities, municipalities, and private businesses. Also, you may want to consider this being a two-way street. If a person continues to get arrested, at some point, I think you would agree, it is in the best interest of our constituents to say to the person who continues to get arrested, we gave you a number of chances. We've given you a lot of chances. You're now going to have to live with the consequences. Under some circumstances, I submit to you, it's way too dangerous to do otherwise. There's a section in the proposed bill that mentions expungement of biometric information. This term is not clearly defined. However, it could be interpreted to mean DNA samples. I'm sure you all realize that stored DNA samples have been not only a very valuable tool in discovering the true perpetrator of an unsolved crime, but has also been a godsend to many who have been falsely convicted and imprisoned. So please let us work with you. I'm being totally sincere when I say we are 100% supportive of what you want to achieve. We work with these laws every day. We know them. We recognize the numerous pitfalls, which you would not be expected to recognize. But when we tell you we want to help you craft a law that gets you toward your goal of true rehabilitation and true reentry into society, we mean it. So let's work together in a relatively short period of time. I know we can craft a law that works for everyone, and we can all stand up on the proverbial courthouse steps and say together, we did a good thing for everyone. So thank you for your time and listening. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, District Attorney Tendi. The next person to testify will be Bronx District Attorney Darcel Clark. DA Clark, you're on the clock.
Thank you so much. And I'm taking some of DA Tendi's time because he left some over. So Senator Bailey and all the senators on the committee, thank you so much for giving us this opportunity. The legislature's goal are laudable in creating clean slate. We do see the need and agree that the collateral consequences of a criminal record significantly impacts the ability to earn a living, to access housing, education, public benefits, voting, and so much more. I was so impressed with the testimony of the first panel. Cedric, I have met several times and have worked on, been on panels before about these types of issues. Melinda, as well as Zakai. Very impressed, very impactful. These are the people we are looking to help with Clean Slate. And I understand the thinking behind Clean Slate automatic sealing and expungement. And it really is a response to what many have identified as an uptake gap or a second chance gap in the petition-based sealing and expungement models. This gap identifies the large percentage of people who are discouraged from applying for relief due to the barriers to access as a result of difficulty navigating our current sealing statute. So many more people could be impacted and have their records sealed if they understood the process or if it was easier for them. So I think that the automatic relief attempts to close that gap by shifting the burden from those who are justice involved to the government stakeholders who can review their records and determine whether someone is eligible for relief without requiring individuals to ask for that relief. We believe in second chances and reasonable measures to seal and expunge criminal records. However, the proposed legislation as presently constructed requires a few fixes that if left unchecked could result in serious public safety concerns. In short, I suggest four things. Narrowing the scope of automatically sealing crimes and leaving that to most misdemeanors and low-level nonviolent felonies. Include court discretion on violent felony convictions. 3, use evidence-based timelines. And 4, create a working committee of criminal justice stakeholders to review proposed amendments to this legislation. These suggestions are based on decades of experience as a judge, as a prosecutor, and a lifelong Bronx resident. I share these potential solutions with you today with an eye towards implementing restorative measures and clean slate initiatives that have the best chance of achieving your legislative intent without consequences that could jeopardize public safety. Let's talk about those under proposed legislation. Almost all crimes are eligible for sealing and expungement. While it's reasonable to consider applying this statute to most misdemeanors and low-level felonies, the proposed legislation is overly broad. It automatically seals violent crimes. The statute should include mechanisms to examine whether the sealing or expungement of violent crime is appropriate and whether criminal conduct at issue was against children, vulnerable adults, or involved in large-scale fraud, dishonesty, or theft. The statute should also provide exemptions for more than just law enforcement to review sealed convictions. For example, schools or childcare providers should be able to check if prospective employees have convictions for child abuse or neglect. Hospitals and nursing facilities should be able to screen for felony convictions based on abuse, injury to patients, and another vulnerable group. Those employed to drive should be screened for DWI convictions, and financial institutions should be able to check for convictions that involve serious theft and fraud. Although the statute does not intend to apply to convictions for sex offenses, the statute must shore up its language to prevent sex offenders from utilizing this legislation as well. I want to go on because I know that my time is short. The statute must accommodate repeat patterns of domestic violence that are presented in a short period of time. I've laid bare a few solutions that could mend the breadth of the crimes covered. I now want to turn to some unique challenges presented when criminal records are automatically sealed and expunged. foremost, there must be some form of review built in to the system to determine if sealing or expungement is correct. And if criminal records fail to meet the statutory criteria for sealing or expungement. Consider this: under the present version, what happens if sealing or expungement is not authorized under the statute because of a recent conviction or because the defendant is under parole or probation, but the conviction is erroneously sealed or expunged? There should be language within the statute that builds in an appropriate checks and balances before criminal records are sealed and expunged. Not that they shouldn't be, but just to make sure that before they are, that they are the appropriate ones. Some of the other factors that I think that it did, that the legislation didn't take into account is the timing, the time requirements. As we take a closer look at time requirements for expungement, in the case of a violent felony conviction, the records are expunged 7 years, excluding the period of incarceration, after sentence on the most recent felony conviction and after completion of probation or parole. 7 years after release and completion of probation or parole is too short to demonstrate merits of the criminal record. The way that it's written now, there's no tolling provision, right? So what happens is if somebody is serving a prison sentence that's longer than the 3 years for the sealing, and that person is still in prison and not under the supervision of probation or parole, that conviction as written now could be sealed while the person is still serving their incarceration. So that's a gap or misstep in the statute that needs to be cleared up. Clearly, this was not the desired result of the legislation. It just demonstrates why this piece of legislation could use more collaboration in its revision.
I know DA, after absorbing the 10D extra minutes, I must unfortunately say that your time is up. And okay. But we will come back with a series of questions. I'm sure that that my colleagues have questions, and we can.
If I could just say this last sentence, last thing, please, Senator Bailey, is that look, this is something that we can work on. Okay, the prosecute. I think that if we provide the opportunity to sit down with you, many of us who are concerned about this, many of us who believe that this will help us. That means I welcome the opportunity to work with you, our criminal justice stakeholders, community partners, to make this legislation viable. If we take a moment to pause the legislation, allow the criminal justice community to come together, the court, the defense bar, advocates, the prosecution and law enforcement, to have a meaningful opportunity to review the amendments and find a consensus, we will be able to achieve sensible reform that restores our impacted community as those individuals that we saw on our first panel. Thank you, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Madam DA. The next district attorney to testify will be the Richmond County District Attorney, colloquially known as Staten Island, Michael McMahon. DA McMahon, you are on the clock.
Thank you, Senator. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Good. Thank you very much, and I want to thank the committee and all the senators for their work on this very important issue, and also join my colleagues in thanking the first panel that spoke this morning and really underscored the need to achieve the goals that are sought with this legislation. And I think that my colleagues pointed out very poignantly that we are more than willing, and rightfully so, to do our duty to work with the Senate and the Assembly to come up with a bill that really does give a clean slate to so many New Yorkers who need it. As D.A. Clark pointed out, I don't have a full amount of testimony to give because I'm here to support and really to reiterate and say that I agree 100% with what they said. And the bottom line is we want to work with you on this. But I do want to point out one thing that's really important to us here in Staten Island. Like the rest of the state and the city, we are confronted with great challenges now with the increase in gun violence and trying to bring forward-thinking solutions to the opioid crisis manifested through overdoses and domestic violence. But we also have here in Staten Island, like some parts of the state, a very serious issue with vehicular crime and drunk driving. And I want the senators just to be mindful of the fact that the way the bill is written, recidivists pose a very serious problem for us when it comes to drunk driving. And under the current law, as was pointed out, there are certain bump ups or enhancements when someone is a repeat offender for drunk driving. And I think that that's important to have that and to be able to enforce those elements of the law, because unfortunately there are a very small number of people who do recidivate and continue to get behind the wheel of a vehicle and put the lives of innocent victims at risk. Just this week alone, we had two arrests here in Richmond County of individuals who for the third and fourth time were behind the wheel, totally, to put it in regular terms, totally drunk beyond the legal limits. And they were good, again, putting people's lives at risk. And so after one chance, and then a second chance, and now a third and fourth chance, it is time to be able to enforce the law. We won't be able to do that if we can't look back, if you will, and see the prior record. So I ask the panel to consider those cases as well as the others that have been pointed out here, in particular in the cases of violence against victims and to consider the rights of those victims and to balance that with the very laudable goals of this legislation. So again, I cannot underscore enough how much we want to work with you to get this right, to protect the rights of those who have been convicted so they can get their lives back on track, but also to protect the rights of the victims and those that we are all sworn to protect under the Constitution. So thank you very much. We look forward to the discussion.
Thank you, DA McMahon. DA Clark, you should have had DA McMahon go before you as well to so that you could have taken some of his time. Yeah. But our next district attorney will be the sister county of Albany County, Rensselaer County DA Mary Pat Donnelly. DA Mary Pat Donnelly, you are on the clock.
Thank you, Senator Bailey. I think we've heard from my colleagues who have summed up most of our significant concerns. I do want to speak again, as DA McMahon just did, regarding the drinking and driving issue. What we often see is someone will have a large gap in their criminal history. And I think we all know at this point that oftentimes those people are not with a license and not driving at that time. And so we don't see what's going on in their lives and we can't measure it via their criminal history. So the fact that there's a gap and we're now not even going to be able to look back and see what their history was prior is concerning. And again, just to underscore what was stated, I think by the attendee is that we're looking at these folks to make job applications. It was brought up in the first panel that this is a civil issue and it's about job enhancement. We're not gonna be able to look back and say, okay, maybe for 10 years they didn't have a drinking and driving conviction, but they had this tendency toward it. And while they can still be a contributing member of society, I think it would be fair for someone hiring them for some kind of a driving job to know that this was what their past entailed. So that is my concern, is that it is so broad and that we're not able to look at what someone may or may not be suited for. Someone in their youth may have had multiple convictions and they may have absolutely turned their lives around, but that is not always the case. And that layer of discretion that DA Clark spoke to, I think is important. And I know we have to balance that with access to justice and the fact that so many people don't want to go back in the courtroom. And I can understand that, but we have to find a balance so that the folks that spoke in the first panel are the people that we're targeting. You have turned your life around. You are giving to your community. You're raising your children. You should not be held back. And I don't think anybody on this panel wants to hold them back, but I think we need to find a way to make sure that we're not letting it slip through the cracks. Another point that I didn't hear brought up is I believe this law is unique to New York. So I am concerned, a small county across the river from Albany, we border both Massachusetts and Vermont. Many of our defendants have fluid ties to the state of Vermont. It's a straight shot from rural Vermont down to the city of Troy. Could this person have a conviction expunged, a New York State conviction expunged, but yet have significant criminal history occurring right across the border? I didn't see anything in the legislation that would call for a look to make sure that that wasn't what was occurring. So you know, my concern is just that it's public safety. That's what this is all about. It's public safety. And I wish that we could build into this legislation a way to determine the folks who are ready to enter society, who have paid their debt and are moving forward, and the folks that we need to inform society about their background so that we can be safe. Maybe they're not suited to be an elder care worker, but they're suited to do something else. Maybe they're not suited to drive a commercial vehicle, but they're suited to do something else. So I think we are on the right track, and I'm very thankful that you are listening to us at this point. And I am heartened by all of the suggestions, and I think we can really do some good here. So thank you for listening.
Thank you, DA Donnelly. We have been joined by Senator Brad Hoylman, and we've also been joined by the assembly sponsor of this legislation, Assemblymember Catalina Cruz. DAs, I want to say thank you for appearing today, and I want to say thank you to something that you've all underlined, especially DA attending this testimony, and DA Donnelly, you just mentioned that. I think the goal here is to ensure that we're working together, and the reality is that whether we agree on every detail or not, the reason why we're having this hearing is because we as a body, a deliberative body, again under the leadership of Andre Stewart Cousins, we certainly want to elicit what you have to say and take it into consideration, excuse me, in crafting legislation that will meet the intended purpose. So with that being said, I will send it over to Senator Murray for questions, followed by Senator O'Mara and other members who utilize the raise hand feature as panelists on your on the Zoom. So Senator Murray, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And let me echo the sentiments of the chairman to thank the DAs for taking the time to be with us today and for expressing your views. You know, I think a lot of times in this space that there can be sort of an adversarial disposition. And I don't think that that's where we are with this. And I think it's good to hear, I think, support for the principle of second chances and allowing people to be productive members of their communities. I'm going to spend the balance of my time just mentioning a couple of things and responding to it. I know many of my colleagues are going to have questions, and I suspect to all my DAs here that this won't be the last conversation that we have, and so we'll be able to get further into the details. But you know, we mentioned just sort of at the top the 160-59 and sort of the limitations there. And you know, I think it's important for us to recognize that application-based ceiling and expungement, while laudable, simply has not worked. And I think it's less than 0.5% of eligible people have applied for this type of relief. And it's why it's important that this be automatic in nature. And I think also important why we have made it as broad as it is, because of some of what we've heard on the previous panel. But what we, I think we all hold to be true is that if an individual has committed an offense, has been tried for it or pled to it and is now convicted and has served the time, that is ostensibly how the system should work. The system is not one in which you serve the consequence for the conviction in perpetuity. And I think, you know, reasonable minds can disagree on what people believe the propensity to commit another offense is based on what you've done previously. And we have an entire body of evidentiary rules to govern what we're allowed to talk about that. But studies and what we've seen suggest that sealing and expungement actually reduces recidivism. And if an individual knows that they have this opportunity, they're less likely to offend. And if they are given the window to more opportunities in housing and education and jobs, that they're less likely to commit offenses as well. You know, there have been a number of other jurisdictions around the country that have some variation of sealing and expungement. I think the most extensive studies have been in Michigan, where we've seen, I think, pretty good results on whether people reoffend, their ability to make more money and to be productive members of their communities. And I think that we are looking really to be in that universe, one in which you're not punished in perpetuity. I mean, that it's automatic in nature, so that you, you know, if you're an individual that had an adverse experience in the justice system, having to re-engage with that system again to get relief, particularly when you've already served out the consequences that that system gave you, I don't think is helpful towards the goal. The public safety concerns that you brought up, I think, are things that we are certainly willing to discuss and consider. I think that, you know, there are portions of this bill, I think we disagree on what it actually means, but I think the conversation around public safety is one that I certainly, as a sponsor, but I, you know, don't want to speak for our chair, but certainly think that we can have that conversation. And I view this very much as a public safety tool. When I talk to the dudes on my block and the people that I represent, they say, Z, I need a job. I don't want to be out here on the corner. I don't want to be out here doing this stuff. I need a job. I need an opportunity. And so when we talk about gun violence and we talk about reducing crime, I view this as a crime fighting tool as well. And I'm hopeful that we can have a really productive conversation. We are not going to agree on everything. And I think that's that is OK. You know, we kind of come at things, I think, in a philosophically different place. But again, I appreciate all of you taking the time, and I look forward to us having more conversations later.
So if there's no response to that, we can go directly to Senator O'Mara. Senator O'Mara, you are on the clock.
Thank you, Chairman Bailey, and thank you to the district attorneys testifying here today. I just want to put my 2 cents worth on this, and that I think we're on the right path to something here with this legislation to provide for more opportunities for those who have gotten their life back on the right track and aid them in being able to do that and helping them. And I think incentivizing, as has been said here, the desire to be on the straight and narrow, so to speak, and stay out of trouble with the criminal law. But I do have concerns that the DAs have raised. I'm a former DA myself from Chemung County, but I also served in the Manhattan DA's office. I think DA Tendi, I started out in 1991 sitting at a desk next to Sheila Tendi. I haven't talked to her in a long time, you know, I have the experiences from both the big city office and rural upstate offices. I've talked to most of the DAs of the 5 counties that I represent, and there is not a whole scale. There is not knee-jerk reaction opposition to this proposal, but there are concerns raised by the DAs in my districts that have been raised by all of you here today. And I think the fact that we have similar concerns raised, we should be paying serious attention to those. And, you know, some of those are the predicate offenses, generally the 10-year window on those in New York State, particularly on DWIs, and the need to for courts to be able, and prosecutors to be able to have access to those. Otherwise, I think on situations like DWIs, if an individual has their record expunged prior to that 10-year predicate period, and they get arrested for another DWI, an astute defendant would come in and immediately plead guilty and have the charge taken care of right there without the ability of the prosecutor or the judicial system to determine that that individual really fit within the window for a predicate DWI offense. So I think things like this can be tightened up. I have concerns over the elimination of fingerprints and DNA evidence for use in future investigations. I think should be there. That certainly can be sealed and withheld from the public and should not be of any detriment to the individual whose information that is from seeking gainful employment and being any block to that in that regard. I want to hear from the DAs on from what you've read of this legislation so far, you would see the extra work of your offices of having to do. And if you could also comment on, there's some requirements in here where your offices would be required to contact any other law enforcement agency or entity involved in your investigations to I think advise them of sealing or expungement. I'm not sure how that would feasibly be done, but if you can comment on the extra work and what kind of expense that would be to your budgets in this concept we're talking about today.
David, you want to take that or anybody? I mean, I could talk about, I think that it's going to be a major consideration. The technology involved, I don't even know how this can actually happen because it's so broad. And it dovetails into so much other of our work, discovery and things of that nature, which this legislature has worked extremely hard to reform. And this will just be another hurdle in getting that done, because after we have to provide all that information, then we push it out. And then if it's expunged or sealed, we have to realize who it is we sent it out to in order to give them notice to tell them that they have to destroy it. But then if somebody gets rearrested, but we still have the ability to seek that information, it will already, you know, be destroyed, and we have to do it all over again. It's just going to be so time consuming and confusing. Like, and also there's going to be mechanisms where the court has to be involved, because if things are sealed, you can't get things unsealed without court orders. So we'll have to do that as well. It's going to take a lot of time, more manpower, to have people to do just this work, just on the expungement and sealing issue. Now, most of us have individuals in our office who are doing the work now. I know that I have a team that's been helping with 16059, but this will take it to a whole new level. We will need more staffing in order to make sure that we can comply with this new law, which right now, as written, is overly broad.
Thank you, DA Clark. DA Soares, you had a follow-up? Or
I do, and it's just, I'll be very brief. Because it seems to me that and listening to certainly to Senator Myrie as he talked about the limitations of 16059, I've expressed to you my frustration with those limitations, and I've also provided some recommendation as to how we can go about curing it to achieve our mutual goal. I guess for me, the only thing that I guess what I'm hearing, and I'm not sure that what I'm hearing is ultimately going to translate into policy, but the biggest flaw in my criticism of 169 was that it was too limiting. And we seem to now be under the belief that by creating an automatic process inclusive of all crimes, that would be the cure. Except that in prescribing that cure, you're also inviting additional problems. And what we're trying to say is that we want to be at the table to help avoid those additional problems. There are some classes of offenses that if you said, okay, there would be automatic expungement and you created the appropriate criteria, we would have agreement. But I cannot see a policy where we think it's appropriate for a school to be hiring a person who's had alcohol-related driving offenses. I can't see where it would be okay to have a policy where a school would be hiring individuals who've had violence in their past to be around youth. I also can't see, you know, a rational policy where an individual who is, you know, who has done their time is getting relief before a victim is actually grappled with their own trauma. So I'm hoping that at some point, that when we continue this discussion, we end up somewhere where the individuals who you started out this hearing with, that these are the people that are getting the benefit, and not, you know, individuals who continue to present a clear and present danger to our communities. As for resources, I would echo what the Bronx District Attorney has said, that we are doing everything now, especially offices that I would say are middle size offices like mine. We are doing every single thing now to be in compliance with the discovery provisions, the additional hearings as a result of bail reform, and to thrust upon prosecutors who also now have the additional burden of being responsible for police records, to thrust upon us now the requirement that we notify all of these agencies without additional funding flowing along with the signing of a bill would render our services, actual cases and victims, it would compromise our ability to render them the appropriate level of services at this point. So I hope that this is the beginning of a discussion, certainly not the end.
Thank you, DA Soares. We're gonna go to Assemblymember Cruz, but I just wanted to ask a really brief question because we're on the point and you spoke about resources. So this can go to any of the district attorneys. And again, this wasn't specifically related for this meeting, but I have a bill and in consultation with Senator Myrie, it's bill Senate print 5518, which would create an office of expungement. Having conversations with many of the district attorneys, I've been made well aware of limitation that you've described in relations to discovery or bail or the number of reforms that we place. So that would be something that I wouldn't ask you to comment on a piece of bill that you on a piece of legislation on a bill that you have yet to review in depth. I think that you're all professionals but it's something that I would ask conceptually. Is that something that you would think about, and could we have a further conversation down the road about said office of expungement? Because it's something that we've thought about in conversations, saying, you know what, this is something that requires actual person power. This isn't a point and click of a mouse that's something that in a record is expunged. So it's something that I would ask that you take a look at in further conversations, and if it gets placed into the clean slate bill, then so be it. But it's something that we should be looking at, because again, it's something that we've recognized that yes, there is a significant amount of person power that is going to go into this. So it's something that I would just like to bring to your attention and have you review. Again, the Senate print 5518.
I would appreciate that, because I think one of the issues that we see sometimes when these laws are done is that conceptually you come up with the law and this is the criteria. But when we say, well, how are you going to do it? How is it going to actually get done? The implementation of it? It's always, oh, well, we'll figure that out, you know, once we get the bill passed. And I think that you are right in thinking about that before the law is actually passed, because it is going to take a tremendous amount of work to get it done. Once you come up with the criteria and everything, we want it to happen, and we want it to happen right. So any type of office that's going to assist in making this happen, I absolutely would love to have more conversations about that, because it's important.
Thank you, Madam DA. If there's no other commentary on that, we will go to Assemblymember Cruz, followed by Senator Myrie, followed by DA Tendy, who had his hand up. Assemblymember Cruz, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for letting me sneak into your hearing. I really appreciate the opportunity not only to hear from the various DAs, but from the affected folks. I've had an opportunity to sit with them and really talk in depth about how this legislation would impact their lives. And so I'm not going to go into whether I agree or not with some of the assertions here or talk about the meat and potatoes of the bill, because my colleague, Senator Myrie, has done that very well. I think for me, one of the most important things to highlight is I hear the concerns from the various DA's offices about the carve-outs, but some of the folks that we've heard from directly impacted folks are exactly those folks who would be carved out if we were to make the changes that you're suggesting. And that concerns me, because it's thousands and thousands of people who would seemingly not benefit from the exact purpose of this bill. And so I often wonder, you know, on the one hand, we're saying, yes, we are supportive of people being able to move forward with their lives and having a job and being able to put a roof over their heads. But it is exactly carving them out that would prevent them from this. Because in practice, what we're seeing is that those folks are not able to move forward with their lives. And so I'm also wondering the thoughts around that from the DA's office. So what do we do with those folks? Do we just say, well, it sucks to be you? You know, it's kind of that mentality of, we want to help you, but just not you, those particular folks. And so I'm not saying that that's the position that the DA's offices are taking, but it almost feels like that. Like we're saying, yes, we're worried about you and we kind of want to help you, but not you. And so it would be also great to hear along with your concerns, your suggestions on how to, if we were to, on some alternative universe, be able to make some of those changes, which I have to be honest, I'm not exactly sure how they would, how we would make them without completely destroying the bill. What do we do with those folks? How do we really help them? The purpose of the bill is to help folks move forward when they come out of jail, get a job, and have a life. And so how do we do that? I think the other thing that I would really like to hear, and it may not necessarily be the place here, and I always ask for that feedback when someone tells me I have a concern with a particular section of the bill is, well, what other language do you have? If there are actual edits that you would like to make, what's the language? And that's something that you could, your teams could send us by email. Because if we're going to have an in-depth discussion about how does a bill impact your ability to do your job, or even the ability of these folks to move forward with their lives, I'd like to see actual suggested changes and not just rhetoric about how do you feel this would impact the community? Because that's always, I think that's always a really good place to start. I'm going to leave it there. Sometimes it's good to keep it short. If anybody wants to chime in, I'd love to hear it.
Well, let me just say this, speaking for my community, and I'm not speaking for any other prosecutor on this panel. You know, when I think that what's confusing is that we start to have these conversations and there's this belief that we're talking about everybody. First of all, I'm not talking about everybody. And quite honestly, I do, again, I want to reiterate, there are certain offenses that I believe perhaps automatic expungement, you know, after a certain period of time to be appropriate. But definitively, what I'm saying is that I would not support any effort to expunge records for people who are chronic, who chronically operate motor vehicles and put others in harm's way. That's, I think the beauty of what took place, the good part of what took place during the discussions of 160.59 is that there was an agreement on a certain class of defendants that would not qualify for this. And I stick by those original negotiations that I believe that sex offenders, I believe that murderers, I believe that chronic people who operate motor vehicles, I agree that people who abuse animals and domestic abusers, I believe that people who prey upon the elderly, I don't believe that those people should be considered to be part of that class that benefits from this kind of sealing and expungement. If you would like to discuss what we do with that class separately from what we do with the other 90% or 95% of the folks that would qualify, we'd be happy to have that discussion. But I think the issue for me is it's wedging those individuals and attempting to create the perfect legislation and at the expense of the good.
Thank you, DA Soares. Senator Myrie, followed by Senator Palumbo.
So I'll actually defer to Senator Palumbo, and I know that some of the DAs also had their hands up and wanted to respond.
Senator Palumbo, followed by DA Tendi, followed by DA Clark. Senator O'Mara, I still see your hand raised. Would you like to come back for another round?
I would, just very briefly.
Okay, just wanted to make sure. So we will go in that order. The ranking member of the committee, Senator Palumbo, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Chairman Myrie, as well. And I think in response to some of the comments that, I think that good government is always balanced, right? I think that what we should really be thinking about is, DA Soares said that there has to be some sort of a balance because we also owe to society and our victims some safety, right? And we've been talking about recidivism rates being reduced. For example, in Michigan, it does work because there are people like our first panel who have made tremendous efforts to get back into society and have made wonderful progress. Those are the folks that should clearly deserve a second chance and a clean slate. But there are certain types of crimes that do create additional risks. And I think that is really what is important to consider, because those states have excluded certain types of crimes, violent, victim-sensitive crimes. You know, and I know that we've made multiple changes regarding the bail reform, for example. That came out, and I was down the hall in the assembly at the time, and I, as a former ADA myself, I debated that, and I said, look, folks, we are triple jumping the line. This is manslaughter is a Class C nonviolent felony. I've handled many of them. Manslaughter is not bail eligible under this original statute. Oh, no, no, it's going to be great for society was the response. And then ultimately, within a few months, we made drastic changes, because I just think that those of us that are that have practiced in this field, like those individuals on this panel, they're not looking to send everyone to jail. The idea of the criminal justice system is to rehabilitate and get people back into society. It doesn't make anybody feel good. Well, I'll speak for myself. Never made me feel good after even a trial as a prosecutor having to recommend, you know, huge sentences, because two families are destroyed, particularly when it's a homicide. This doesn't make anybody happy, but there needs to be that balance. And that's really what I think we need to consider, because, for example, all of these other states do have reasonable types of reasonable law to the extent that violent crimes and forgery crimes, crimes of dishonesty, those don't necessarily get sealed, even not as quickly. If ultimately somewhere down the road, 15, 20 years or whatever we ultimately agree upon, that just needs to be considered. So I do appreciate the comments, and I just think we need to make sure that we consider that balance, because we do owe certainly a debt to everyone, including those folks that are victims could possibly become subsequent victims when it comes to violent crimes, most importantly. So I do appreciate you the opportunity to make those comments again, Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Palumbo. I think let me go back to the members, DAs, if you don't mind. I wanted to go back to Senator O'Mara briefly for a second round, and then permit the district attorneys to comment further, because it looks as if we have no other members speaking. Senator O'Mara, the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you again, Chairman, for the indulgence to go second round. I would just encourage the DAs on this panel, and I'm encouraging the DAs from the five counties I represent to have the State DA's Association put in a full position paper on this to the legislature. I have received, some outline materials already from the State DA's Association on this, but with many of the concerns that have been raised today. So if you could just relay that to your statewide association, I think they provide great direction for us in the legislature, and would like to have that in a more formal letter or statement. So thank you.
Thank you, Senator.
And as part of that, encourage them to look at other states to see what may be working out there already, and give us some outline of what you feel works in other states and what doesn't.
Thank you, Senator O'Mara. DA Tendi, followed by DA Clark.
Thank you very much. I think what Senator O'Mara and Senator Cruz said regarding what's the language, that's obviously the number one question. And I think the District Attorneys Association, as I said earlier, we really welcome the chance, the opportunity to submit language to you that might address some of these concerns. I thought Senator Myrie, I don't know if you did it intentionally or you did it on purpose, but you brought up a really good point. You said that this is a crime-fighting tool. It kind of struck me as an odd thing to say, but as I thought about it, that's exactly what this is. Being able to bring people back into society and not have them suffer the consequences of something that happened a long time ago will help them become better citizens. So I think if we all look at this law, not from our individual, I guess for lack of a better term, viewpoints, but look at it for what it's intended to do. I think if we look at it as a crime-fighting tool, that really brings us together. And I really think that we can submit suggestions and have a real good discussion about it and come to a real good solution to this. I think this proposed legislation has a lot of promise. And I think if we step out of our individual boxes and look at it a little differently, I think we can come up with some really good solutions. And by the way, I don't want anybody to ever forget, most people who commit crimes don't recommit. However, there are such things as career criminals, and we have to remember both of that. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, DA Tandy. DA Clark.
Yes, thank you, Senator. To Assembly Member Cruz, I absolutely would love to help submit solutions. I think anytime anybody knows that when I testify in hearings like this, or as I'm working with the legislature, I try not to be that person that's wagging my finger saying, oh, this is terrible, terrible, terrible. I'm always the one, I try to be Switzerland at all times. So I always want to come up with solutions. So I would absolutely welcome the opportunity to submit some of those solutions. We will do this based on, and some of our positions that we're taking today are based on best practices, us knowing what does work and what has not worked around the country, to help inform us on how to testify here and how to help you make a better law that would be beneficial to everybody. So I absolutely would do that. Senator Myrie, the crime fighting tool in public safety, it absolutely does that, because on my block and the dudes that I speak to tell me the same thing. And when I go to them and say, look, I need you to put that gun down, you tell me, I'm the DA of the Bronx, I got a lot of resources. Tell me what I need to do for you to get you to put that gun down, and I'll make sure that it happens. So this is absolutely one of those things that can happen, because this is what they need in order to be more productive members of society. So I get that, and I want us to get there. And lastly, I think that we should not focus on what we can't do, but what we can do. And I find that a lot of times, and you senators have to realize, and you have to I think you probably recognize that the tone is totally different right now than you've had the experiences in the past with DASNY, okay? So that's the first thing I want you to recognize, that we mean this. You know, we're not new to this. We're true to this. We do this work, and we want to help you make our communities better. So let's focus on the things that we know we can do. Let's talk about the consensus that we can come to on the things that can happen, because we agree that we can get this done on certain crimes. Let's get those out of the way. We don't have to waste time on those when we could come to the agreement and focus more of the time on those things where we do have some disagreements, we don't see eye to eye, and then try to come to a consensus or a conclusion on those. I think that we can make it happen. You did it with the bail reform. I was a DA that was in favor of bail reform, a former judge setting bail, sending people to prison. I know what it's all about. You eventually wanted a cashless bail system, which I would have agreed to, but you couldn't make that happen. But what did you do? You took the things that everybody could agree on, passed those, and continued to work on the other things that were more difficult. I'm asking that we do the same thing here. You can get this done with our support. You will have some of us standing there with you when you do this, if we make sure that we do it in an informed way. We'll give you the best practices. We'll give you as many suggestions as we can. We may not always agree, but knowing that you're keeping an open mind and that we're keeping an open mind, we'll be able to make this happen. I'm assured of it.
Thank you, DA Clark. Seeing no further questions, I will close with this. I'd like to thank you all for testifying. And as you mentioned, the tone has certainly been different. It is more of an open conversation. And again, to all of the district attorneys on that, we've had productive conversations on a number of issues when we've had the chance to speak. And I expect no less in this one. And I want to thank you for your earnest and actual willingness. And District Attorney Clark is a constituent of mine. And so it is important to know that when you're talking about the people and the individuals that Senator Myrie mentioned, or that DA Clark mentioned, these are also people that I see in my neighborhood. And we speak about the movie Miracle, the 1980 US hockey team, where the phrase was, great moments are born out of great opportunity. And you can't have a great moment without having an actual opportunity, albeit a great one. So I want to talk about opportunity. I did want to underline one thing about the issues with the schools. I know it's a major concern, but there are significant and serious background checks that some of these organizations have. So when we're doing these conversations about excluding certain crimes, we should also look at some of the policies that these schools have. The DOE has a robust policy, a robust agency. Yeah, I think it's the OSPRA unit, from my understanding. And so we can talk about those things. But I just want to make sure that we know that there are systems that are set in place. We should have further conversations. And I'm grateful to all of you for your time. And just want to say thank you for testifying.
Thank you to you all.
Thank you. The next panel will be a law enforcement panel, and it will be led by the chief of department, Rodney Harrison. And Chief Harrison will likely have to leave us early because he is swearing in a brand new class of recruits today at the world's most famous arena. And so, you know, when Chief Harrison leaves, that is the rationale why he is taking off. He's also going to be joined by Oleg Chernovsky, and I need to get Oleg's title, Assistant Deputy Commissioner of the New York City Police Department, as well as Chauncey Parker. Mr. Parker's title is Deputy Commissioner of Community Partnerships of the NYPD. We will also be joined by Wayne Harris, Deputy Chief, retired, and Speaker from a Law Enforcement Action Partnership. So, Chief Harrison, the floor is yours.
Good morning. Good morning, Chair Bailey, Senator Murray, and members of the Senate. You know, Chair Bailey, me being a resident of Queens, I am a New York Met fan, but just to let you know, I have no problem driving over the Frog's Neck and going to see a Yankee game. So, hopefully that will help out my hearing today. I would like to start off by making clear that the NYPD agrees that a person that completes their sentence and demonstrates that they have moved on from criminal behavior should not have their past used to forever negatively impact their ability to acquire housing, employment, benefits, education, or other services. The Senate has correctly identified inequities in this area, and we appreciate a move toward a more rehabilitative ceiling and expungement system. Mr. Smith, Ms. Agnew, Mr. Fulton, listening to them, we have to acknowledge that their challenges are real. But we must also acknowledge a truth. The deck is stacked against individuals being released from prison. If our goal is to ensure that they will become a productive member of society and lead the life of crime, it is a mind-boggling to me that we are not addressing the systematic flaws that allow these individuals to be released from prison after serving their sentence with a bus ticket, a small amount of money, and an identification that says parolee as their sole form of identification. Many individuals are released into homeless shelters as there is no plan devised in contemplation of their release to ensure stable housing. Many are simply dropped off and expected to make do and not fall back into the life of crime. Clearly, against all odds. The bill being heard today focuses on cleaning the slate for individuals that have stayed out of trouble for a period of time, so their potential will not be undermined by the stigma of their conviction. That is a good step. What I'm suggesting is a focus to be placed on a post-release plan, so they are given a fair chance to get to the place where they can get rid of the stigma, providing New York State non-driver ID without charge upon release, one that does not label them a convict, ensure that no one gets released from prison and delivered into a shelter. Those would certainly be two fair initial steps that would start them on the right path. Turning back to the legislation being heard today, while the NYPD agrees in creating equity for individuals that have paid their debt to society and are now maintaining a life free of crime, the department urges the Senate to consider crafting improvements to the sealing and expungement system in a way that does not negatively impact public safety and ensure that victims of crimes are not left paying the price in our collective journey to better the criminal justice system. In order to strike this balance, the department recommends that none of these records be destroyed and that law enforcement agencies be permitted to continue to access these records for legitimate law enforcement purposes while blinding the outside world to previous convictions that meet the criteria the final version of this legislation will set out. This will enable people to move on in their lives while at the same time maintaining public safety in communities around this state. As an example, this bill, as currently written, will have an adverse effect on law enforcement's use of photographic identifications. In 2017, you amended the criminal procedure law to permit the introduction of photographic identifications at trial in criminal and juvenile proceedings as part of the prosecutor's case in chief, provided they are conducted using a blind or blinded procedure. In order to help avoid wrongful convictions, that same year, the NYPD undertook a series of reforms designed to improve the quality and reliability of photographic identifications. These reforms included a complete overhaul and redesign of the photo manager system and the adoption of best practices developed by the department in conjunction with the District Attorney's Association of the State of New York and other New York State law enforcement and criminal justice agencies. The Clean Slate Bill would seal and subsequently expunge any photograph of a convicted defendant taken for an eligible conviction, prohibiting the NYPD from maintaining those photographs in the photo manager system and thereby preventing their use in any of the four types of photographic identifications: photo arrays, mugshot viewings, set book viewings, and confirmatory photographic viewings, despite properly conducted identification procedures. Since all photographs used must be of similar size, quality, style, and appearance, in order to prevent the photographic identification procedure from being unduly suggestive, the NYPD relies on the use of arrest photographs as fillers in our identification procedures, limiting or eliminating law enforcement's ability to continue to use arrest photographs in order to conduct viable identification procedures that may be used as evidence in criminal cases would undeniably hinder the ability of witnesses to identify assailants. The same is true for the New York State DNA databank. Pursuant to the New York State executive law, the state DNA databank contains DNA profiles of individuals who have been convicted of a felony or penal law misdemeanor. This bill will require the removal of tens of thousands of DNA samples from the index. The DNA database was created specifically to help police solve serious crimes like sexual assaults and murders, and provide evidence that has seen the exoneration of people who have been wrongly convicted. This bill, as written, would severely undermine these important goals that help achieve justice and promote public safety. These records are invaluable to officers in the field. Officers responding to domestic violence incidents need to be aware of previous convictions of a similar nature that occur in that home. If officers are blinded to what has gone on previously, the department would be prevented from dispatching domestic violence officers to perform outreach, wellness checks, and to offer services to families that have had multiple instances of domestic violence. Likewise, officers executing search warrants or answering radio runs cannot be blind to the fact that individuals behind the door have had previous convictions for weapons possessions. I don't think any of us would disagree that police officers are forced to place themselves in danger every time that they put on this uniform. It is incumbent upon us to ensure that every effort is made to minimize that risk and to access by law enforcement to the types of records this bill seeks to expunge is vital. Moreover, eliminating access
to Chief Harrison, if I may, I know you're a little bit over time and I know you have to go at 12, but so I wanted to see if you can wrap up within the next couple of seconds just so that we can see if we can get a couple of questions in before you go.
Got it. So the NYPD favors laws that are both fair to the communities we serve as well as those accused and convicted of committing crimes. This law should be calibrated to ensure that people are not adversely impacted in their job search or obtaining housing while allowing law enforcement to utilize records that promote public safety. We are ready and willing to work with the Senate, Assembly, and the governor in an effort to create a fairer criminal justice system that maintains public safety for all New Yorkers. Thank you for the opportunity to appear here today.
Thank you. Thank you, Chief. So what we're going because of the time constraints, we're going to go a little bit out of order. And if people have questions for Chief Harrison, we'll have those questions first, followed by Deputy Commissioner Chernofsky. So Senator Myrie, the floor is yours.
Yeah, so I don't have a question. I just wanted to thank the chief for taking the time. I know it's a busy day, and so we appreciate the feedback. We will continue to have conversations with the NYPD, and I appreciate that there is support for the general principle of this bill and for giving folks a second chance and being able to be productive members of their communities. We will take all of the public safety concerns that you express under advisement, but just wanted to thank you for taking the time today.
Senator, thank you.
Thank you, Senator Myrie. Assemblymember Cruz, is there anything for, or Senator Palumbo, does anybody have anything else?
No, thank you, Chairman.
Seeing none, I'd like to thank you again, Chief, for your echo the sentence of Senator Myrie. Thank you for testifying and making time in an incredibly busy day for you and taking some time out. We certainly, as a committee, will be in touch and having further conversations. But again, your willingness to in recognition that individuals, in fact, do deserve a second chance is greatly appreciated. So at that point, we will continue with the rest of the panel with this Oleg Chernofsky, Assistant Deputy Commissioner Commissioner of the NYPD. Assistant Deputy Commissioner Chernofsky, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Senator, but the chief delivered the prepared statement on behalf of the department. I'll just be available for any questions that may come up.
Okay, Mr. Parker, is there any, do you have any testimony?
No, Commissioner Chernofsky, I'm available for any questions.
Okay, and I guess seeing none, I think that this might be a record that that the NYPD has has finished testimony this quickly. But again, we thank you for appearing. We thank you for submitting the written testimony, and we certainly will be in touch.
Sorry, Mr. Chair. Forgive me.
Senator Kavanaugh at the buzzer.
I thought there might be a few other hands that I wanted to let my colleagues with greater expertise go first. But just one question. This idea of ensuring that people who are released receive a non-driver ID. Are there any other jurisdictions that you're aware of that do that?
I can just answer this way, Senator. I'm not aware. I'm very familiar with this particular issue. I can't imagine I just know New York State, and New York State, I think it's just a flaw in the statute that could be fixed very quickly. But under the current practice, if you're in custody, if you're in prison, the law allows somebody to get a DMV ID, which they can get for free while they're in prison. When they leave prison, and maybe the law was written before parole and docs merged, But if you're on community supervision, then all of a sudden that it's no longer free. And I know that because through the HIDA grant, which is a law enforcement grant that with the police department, we're actually paying for that ID right now for people coming home from prison. We have over a thousand people who have an ID that was paid for by law enforcement. And it's just a flaw in the statute. I just think that if it was corrected that anybody, and there, this is a 1,000-mile journey in terms of improving our reentry strategies and giving people this opportunity to be successful coming home. But that's one that could be, in my view, could be fixed easily and could be fixed right away, which is just to add that clause that if you're in prison or you're on community supervision, a driver's license is free, a non-driver's ID is free. And then all of a sudden, and then that would be a path that would be one step forward in giving people this opportunity.
And do you know if it's common for people to receive those upon before their release?
Senator, we're having a hard time hearing you. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. I don't know. I'm sitting at my normal Senate issued computer here. But do you know, is it common for people? I mean, what percentage of people who actually are released come out with an ID?
I know that DOCS has that statistic because they keep track of it. But I do know that there is a substantial number that leave without the DMV ID, and the ID that they leave, I think, says New York State Department of Corrections released. Is sort of that's the ID they have until and that's what they walk onto the street with, that they don't get the DMV ID in prison. But I do know at 40th Street, because we paid for the DMV equipment through this grant and we paid for the licenses to this grant, that over 1,000 so far have had to take care of this service. This is a partnership with parole and with DMV, but I just think it's a flaw in the statute that could be corrected, and it would be a very helpful step forward.
Thank you very much. And I share, you know, thank you all for your testimony, and thank you to the chair and to the sponsor. I know this is a small part of this, but it was something I wanted to get clarity on. So thank you.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you, Senator Kavanaugh. Seeing no further questions, I would like to thank the members of the NYPD for their testimony today. And we will shift over to Mr. Wayne Harris, retired deputy chief and speaker of the Law Enforcement Action Partnership. Good afternoon, Mr. Harris. The floor is now yours. Please reset the clock to 5 minutes. Thank you. The floor is yours.
Good afternoon, Chairman Bailey. Thank you to all the distinguished members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today in support of Senate Bill 1553A and Assembly Bill 6399, which would provide a two-step process for automatic expungement. I'm here today representing myself, having spent over 30 years in law enforcement, retiring as a deputy chief of police from the Rochester, New York Police Department, and as a speaker and board chair for the Law Enforcement Action Partnership, commonly referred to as LEAP. LEAP is a nonprofit group of police, prosecutors, judges, and other criminal justice professionals who speak from firsthand experience. Our mission is to make communities safer by focusing law enforcement resources on the greatest threats to public safety, promoting alternatives to arrest and incarceration, addressing the root causes of crime, and working towards healing police-community relations. As a result of over 30 years in policing and encountering numerous individuals that have gone through our criminal justice system, it is clear that carrying a criminal conviction or convictions produces challenges that are often insurmountable. Among these challenges is the difficulty in gaining meaningful employment, giving some individuals few options but to return to crime if they want to support themselves or their families. You're now considering clean slate expungement bill that would clear old records automatically so that a criminal record does not need to be a permanent barrier to participating in one's community. I believe this bill would greatly improve recidivism rates and bring New York State in line with other states passing clean state laws. One reason people return to crime is because their criminal record is an obstacle to legal employment and stable housing. I recall as a young officer with the Rochester Police Department chasing a young man down the street carrying a television set. By the time this young man was of working age, his criminal record had become a barrier to finding a real job. As I'm certain you are aware, when people with criminal records apply for jobs or housing, employers, landlords, and housing authorities frequently deny their application based on their convictions. If individuals cannot support themselves or their family, or if they face homelessness, they are far more likely to reoffend to survive. This problem is significant in our state since 2.3 million New Yorkers, as we heard earlier today, have criminal records and criminal convictions. When you have no hope of being able to participate in society, the only hope you're left with is to survive. There is a remedy for people trapped indefinitely by their criminal justice records. The expungement bill currently being considered would seal or erase someone's criminal record after a period of time of good behavior so they can have a fresh start, excuse me, in the job market and in the housing market. There is evidence to support this. A recent study in the Harvard Law Review showed that people who obtained expungements were less likely to reoffend. This process would also have the added benefit of freeing our court system from the time and expense which results from high recidivism rates. New York has an opportunity to be a leader as clean state laws are sweeping the nation. Pennsylvania was the first to pass clean slate legislation, followed by Utah, Michigan, and most recently, Virginia. Today, active clean state campaigns are underway in states including Connecticut, Delaware, Louisiana, Texas, and Oregon. As a former police officer and retired deputy chief, I'm encouraged by the work of New York leaders to advance clean slate legislation. Now that millions of New Yorkers have completed their sentences, we would all benefit by creating a process to have their records sealed and expunged. Once those who have served their sentences are allowed to fully rejoin society, they will contribute to healthier families and safer communities. With clean slate legislation, everyone wins. So I thank you for the opportunity to share my experiences, and I look forward to any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Deputy Chief Harris. Senator Myrie.
You know, I would similarly just thank you, Deputy Chief Harris, for taking the time to come and testify before us today. I think we will be having continued conversations. I think your input might be particularly helpful as we discuss some of the NYPD's concerns around their ability to investigate. And so again, just wanted to say thank you for taking the time.
Thank you, Senator Myrie, and I look forward to participating in the conversation.
Assemblymember Cruz? Seeing none, I would echo the sentiments of Senator Myrie, indicating that we stand at the ready to work with you and the NYPD and all members of law enforcement who share these concerns. Again, we pride ourselves in being an incredibly deliberative body. I'll say it once again, and the level of expertise that you have that you've had in your career is something that I, as a legislator, as an attorney, I have not walked the same streets as you, literally or figuratively. So I would say that your expertise is critical, as is the chief's and as is the members of the NYPD. And the more conversations that we have, the better. I will say in relation to this, in the last panel, time is of the essence. So the sooner, the better. The sooner we have these conversations, the more people, as you've said, Deputy Chief Harris, as you said, like the less people that we have running down our proverbial streets carrying those TVs because they have nothing else to do and no other way to eat and to survive. So I just want to say thank you again. And we will go to our next panel. And I want to thank you, the members of law enforcement, for their testimony and for what they do to protect us as well. Thank you all.
Thank you.
The next panel will be a number of attorneys who can attest to, who will testify about what they believe about clean slate. And that is beginning with Alice Fontier, president of the New York State Association of Criminal Defense Lawyers, Samantha Reiser, the staff attorney of the Legal Action Center, Ames C. Growert, senior counsel, Justice Program, Brennan Center for Justice at the NYU School of Law, Scott D. Leave, chief policy counsel from the Bronx Defenders, Stephen Dunn, senior staff attorney, Community Service Society of New York, Sonny Joe, staff attorney, Special Litigation Unit of the Legal Aid Society, and Kingsley Rowe, forensic social worker of the Reentry Unit, New York County Defender Services. We will begin with President Fontier. I just want to remind you, we have 5 minutes to testify, and President Fonteer, you are on the clock.
Thank you, Senator. And as Senator Bailey said, I'm Alice Fontier. I'm the president of the New York State Association of Criminal Defense Lawyers, NYSACDL, the state's largest criminal bar association, which is comprised of both private and public defense attorneys. Our organization strongly supports the Clean Slate Act. As an association of criminal defense lawyers in this state, we are acutely aware that the punishments our clients face do not end when they leave the criminal courthouse or walk out of prison. The stain of a criminal record is deep-seated and lasting. It touches nearly every facet of our clients' lives, from their access to stable housing and employment to educational and volunteer opportunities. It follows them and their families for years, stigmatizing them in a society where many employers, landlords, and officials are unwilling to see the person behind the record. And its influence reaches and shapes entire communities, especially where systemic racism is embedded in every facet of the criminal legal process, so disproportionately saddles Black and Brown New Yorkers with misdemeanor and felony convictions that exclude them from meaningful avenues for economic security and reentry. We support and call for the advancement of the Clean Slate Act because we believe that our clients need a faster, more expansive, and more inclusive means of clearing their records so that they aren't permanently and unjustly disadvantaged by their past. Those of us who work in my field meet people who are adversely affected by their unsealed criminal records every single day. Each person's story and circumstances are unique, but their experiences are bound together by a shared theme: the perpetual punishment of carrying a criminal record. Here in New York, punishment is not contained to the prison time, parole time, and fines prescribed in court. It also exists in the aftermath as our clients seek housing, employment, education, and other necessities. The scope of this problem is alarming. I will highlight the story of one individual, but I want to emphasize that this is one of the most widespread and pressing issues facing our clients. Michael Grant, not his real name, but as I will refer to him, Michael Grant is now a 50-year-old father of three. He was first arrested and imprisoned in 1988 at the age of 17. After getting into a fight with two men, one of whom had a gun that went off. Michael was convicted of attempted murder and finished high school in prison. While there, Michael took anger management classes that introduced him to skills he relies on to this day. As a result, he has never been convicted of another violent offense. But his conviction made it nearly impossible to find stable employment upon his release. And in 1993, at the age of 22, he began selling drugs and was arrested and imprisoned again. While incarcerated, Michael committed himself to building skills that would make him employable. When he was released again, he secured work and held a steady cleaning job until 2008. But when his company folded, he found himself unemployed. Struggling to support his two children, he returned to selling drugs. Despite his years of employment, his criminal record once again emerged from the past to hold him back in the present. In 2008, he received his third and last criminal conviction. Instead of providing financial support for his children, he was separated from them for 5 more years in prison. Since that time, Michael has made an enormous effort to maintain steady employment as a custodian and support his family. He dreams of opening his own cleaning business. But he knows that with a criminal record, he is unlikely to find the investment and other support he needs. Given the violent felony on his record, he is ineligible for sealing and forever haunted by the choices he made at 17 and the choices he was forced to make after that as a result of his record. Current sealing and record relief mechanisms are wholly inadequate to allow individuals like Michael Grant to support their families and avoid recidivism after initial contact with the criminal legal system. The only general sealing provision currently effective, CPL 16059, permits sealing in highly limited situations An individual must wait a full 10 years after their last conviction, so long as they have no more than two convictions total. Only one of those convictions can be a felony, and it can't be classified as violent. These requirements are too restrictive. We cannot expect people like Michael Grant to find meaningful employment, support their families, and truly move beyond the criminal legal system if they are required to wait a full 10 years before a chance at sealing their records. The inability to seal in a timely manner only creates opportunities for recidivism. Likewise, excluding individuals who have more than two total convictions or a violent felony fails to account for the reality that for people like Michael Grant, the fact of a criminal record itself is what often triggers recidivism. While certificates of good conduct and relief from disability are other tools at our disposal that can help our clients obtain specific jobs and licenses, they too fall short. They don't guarantee employment, are difficult to obtain, and only apply to one small part of our clients' lives. The Clean Slate Act is precisely the tool needed to end the perpetual punishment of our clients. While mechanisms like the Fair Chance Act, certificates of relief, and other anti-discrimination provisions provide some protections, they do not provide full opportunities for reentry and rehabilitation. Only through the sealing of a criminal record for civil purposes can this state ensure the end of perpetual punishment. Importantly, the Clean Slate Act does this with essential expediency by providing for sealing of misdemeanors 1 year after sentencing and felonies 3 years after sentencing. The Clean State Act ensures individual with a criminal record will be able to seek housing, employment, education, and all of the essentials of life more quickly after their conviction. That time, as Michael Grant's story attests, matters. Second, the applicability of the Clean Slate Act to all criminal convictions, regardless of numbers of severity of offense, is also essential for the equitable application of sealing and the opportunity for full reintegration that comes with it. As we know too well, people of color are disproportionately impacted by every stage of criminal legal involvement. From arrest to plea negotiations.
I have to give you a 15 second warning. I messed up your name on the pronunciation earlier, so that's why I'm giving you 15 extra seconds.
Okay. From arrest to plea, Black and brown New Yorkers face significant consequences and are disproportionately impacted by the criminal legal system. The Clean State Act is not just essential, it is also essential for racial justice in this state. We urge you to pass it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Fontier. And I do earnestly apologize for the mispronunciation of your name when I announced the panel earlier. I certainly do apologize for that.
No apology necessary, Senator.
Well, thank you. The next panelist would be Samantha Reiser. I hope I got that right, because I'm going down the rabbit hole of pronunciation. So the staff attorney from the Legal Action Center, Attorney Reiser, you are on the clock.
Thank you, Senator. Good morning. My name is Samantha Reiser, and I'm a staff attorney at the Legal Action Center, where I work with clients facing barriers because of their arrest and conviction histories. Legal Action Center is also a member of Clean Slate Steering Committee. I would like to thank the Senate for holding this important hearing. Today, our neighbors with conviction records return to their communities only to be followed by the specter of their convictions in perpetuity. Rather than having access to the very opportunities they need to succeed, steady employment, safe housing, healthcare, and education, they face systemic discrimination that undermines their ability to move forward in their lives. This impact reverberates across their families and communities. Almost 50% of children in the U.S. have at least one parent with a criminal record. Meanwhile, a recent study found that people who serve carceral sentences lose an average of almost $500,000 in wages over their lifetime. The impact of a conviction record is not borne equally. According to a recent study by the Data Collaborative for Justice, between 1990 and 2019, Black and Latinx people made up nearly 80% of people with records in New York City, despite accounting for just 55% of the population. This mirrors statewide trends and also compounds existing inequities in employment and housing, where people of color already experience race-based discrimination. Senate Bill 1553A offers a path forward for New York to mitigate the racial and economic harm that convictions inflict upon individuals and their attendant harm to families and communities. The core tenets of this legislation: relief for all, automatically and as soon as possible solve the current deficiencies in our records clearance laws that keep individuals with convictions in a state of perpetual punishment. Senate Bill 1553A is based on the fundamental principle that all people should be provided a meaningful opportunity to move beyond their conviction following the successful completion of their carceral and community supervision and a period with no new conviction. This is sound policy. People returning to their communities today are blocked from the very opportunities they need to help stabilize their lives. These barriers are systemic and can force our fellow New Yorkers into desperate situations, which increases recidivism and undermines community safety. The value of clean slate is well supported by evidence. One study found that within 1 year after expunging their records, people were earning 22% higher wages, and that within 5 years, individuals were less likely than members of the public to be reconvicted. 1553A is also fair policy. Anything short of clean slate for all New Yorkers would only entrench racial disparities. That same Data Collaborative for Justice study found that while just 36% of white people with conviction records had at least one felony conviction, this number was 57% for Black people. This is the intentional byproduct of a system that discriminates against communities of color. 1553A proposes a two-tier system to records clearance. Initially, conviction records would be sealed for most civil purposes before full expungement several years later. The first tier of records clearance sealing would occur when someone completes all community supervision and when at least 1 year has passed since their last misdemeanor conviction and at least 3 years have passed since their last felony conviction, excluding time spent incarcerated. By expediently sealing conviction records for civil purposes, 1553A would provide transformative opportunities to people at a highly determinative time. When a conviction record is sealed, it would be made inaccessible for most civil purposes, but would remain accessible to key legal systems actors, including courts and prosecutors. Additionally, and this is critical, for sensitive jobs or licenses that the state has determined require additional screening processes and therefore require fingerprinting, such as teachers, which was previously mentioned, access to conviction records would continue until the expungement period, when recidivism research shows people with convictions are no more likely to be reconvicted than the general public. Records would receive full expungement at years 5 for misdemeanors and 7 for felonies, again excluding time spent incarcerated, and only if a person did not incur an additional conviction during this time. At this point, expungement would make a record inaccessible to most actors in civil and legal contexts. Notably, this bill, as written, does not include DNA in the list of information that would be destroyed, nor does it amend the other laws that govern the use of DNA information and retention. Additionally, driving-related convictions and suspensions would remain on DMV abstracts, which driving-related employers may access and which would not in any way be impacted by Senate Bill 1553A. There are some exceptions to expungement which would leave intact the consideration of convictions in certain other proceedings. Notably, if a person were subsequently charged, the fact of a prior conviction would be available for charging bump-ups and sentencing enhancements. Finally, 1553A would not override laws governing federal clearance, such as for some banking jobs, or laws of other jurisdictions. This is a New York State law, unfortunately. We can't tell federal agencies what to do. But critically, 1553A's ultimate relief would be expungement. This is a necessary component of ensuring individuals are not forever tethered to their convictions in civil and criminal legal contexts. For too long, New York has devalued the dignity and contributions of the 2.3 million New Yorkers living with convictions. This bill would rectify this. We thank Senator Myrie for his sponsorship of this legislation and co-senators Bailey, Benjamin, Biagi, Britsport, and Kumi for their co-sponsorship. We and our Clean Slate partners look forward to working with the Senate to bring this important and critically needed legislation to New York. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Reiser. The next panelist, Ames C. Growert, Senior Counsel, Justice Program from the Brennan Center of Justice at NYU School of Law. You are on the clock.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, and thank you for the opportunity to testify today. As you said, my name is Ames Growert, and I'm Senior Counsel in the Justice Program at the Brennan Center for Justice. The Brennan Center is a nonpartisan law and policy institute that works to improve our systems of democracy and justice for all Americans. The Center's Justice Program works to end the crisis of mass incarceration, that is, the historic growth of America's prison system and the resulting devastating collateral consequences for our communities. Most recently, we've worked to document the connection between mass incarceration and poverty and develop and advocate for solutions that break that link. I'm joining you today to explain why S-1553A, the Clean Slate Act, would expand the economic opportunities for people with a criminal record and help ensure that a criminal conviction does not entail a lifetime of punishment and marginalization. Our research shows that a criminal record has a serious and long-lasting impact on someone's ability to earn a living wage and renders illusory the promise of a real second chance after conviction or imprisonment. We know that time in prison significantly impacts someone's well-being, socially, economically, physically, and incarceration has tremendous consequences on families and communities. In a recent paper, we put a number on those findings. We do this through an economic methodology designed by my colleague, Dr. Terrian Craigie, a tenured economics professor, soon to be at Smith College. Our research shows that people who have spent time in prison earn roughly half as much as people who are otherwise similar to them, but have no such experience in the criminal justice system. Perhaps more disturbingly, those effects do not fade over time. Instead, we show that people who have spent time in prison miss out on roughly $500,000 relative to their socioeconomic peers. These trajectories are also, it varies by race significantly, such that people of color bear these burdens disproportionately. I'm sure many of us are unsurprised to learn that, but disheartened nonetheless. While less severe convictions, even without time in prison, also reduce someone's earning potential in the short and long term. We show that a felony conviction reduces earnings by a little over 20%. Even a misdemeanor conviction reduces annual earnings by 15%. All told, we estimate that a criminal conviction of some type costs someone about $100,000 over the course of a career. This apparent connection between criminal justice and poverty has serious consequences for New York State. Lost earnings related to time in prison cost the state an estimated $1.9 billion every year in reduced earning potential. Those losses are felt by the nearly 340,000 New Yorkers who, we estimate, have spent some time in prison, and most of whom, again, are people of color, reflecting the profound racial disparities in our justice system. Unfortunately, due to a lack of available data, we're not able to reliably estimate the statewide impact of convictions, but it is likely quite large. As we've heard many times today, there are more than 2.3 million people with criminal convictions in New York State, and an effect of any size felt by that many people must definitionally be huge. By the way, we also encourage the legislature to support agencies that perform data collection and analysis on the criminal justice system. That is vital for our work and for the understanding of the justice system, and we're grateful for the work of analysts at the Division of Criminal Justice Services. Moving back to the subject, there are many, many factors that explain why time in the justice system correlates with poverty, but one factor is undoubtedly that criminal records are public and permanent. Unlike many of our peer nations, the United States does not recognize a right to rehabilitation or privacy when it comes to criminal record information. To quote the late NYU Law School professor James Jacobs, a criminal record is for life. There is no statute of limitations. Sealing and expungement are the solution to this problem. As we've heard several times today, those laws simply provide for a criminal record to phase out over time slowly. That provides a meaningful second chance for people with a criminal record. We note with gratitude the legislature's work on the 2017 sealing bill. However, as we've recently heard, that law is not helping as many people as it should. We heard during the panel with prosecutors that just 2,498 people, which is an updated stat I just heard today, which is great to know, have received sealing relief under the law. That's of an estimated 600,000 people eligible. This is not unique to New York State. Researchers in other states have shown that there's a serious, quote, uptake gap between sealing applications, or between sealing eligibility and actual relief. Michigan studies show this as well. My time is running out. I trust the committee is familiar with S-1553A's provisions, so I'll close by noting that the bill takes care to balance the need for broad sealing relief against public safety concerns. First, the bill's phase-out periods are sufficiently long to account for recidivism. We know, based on decades of research, that recidivism among people released from prison or convicted of a crime peaks early and then plateaus. Expungement comes in at year 7 for felonies. That profoundly minimizes the risk that people will commit a new crime after expungement. Recidivism sort of stabilizes around year 5 for felonies. Second, the bill has important carve-outs for people who may apply for a firearm license or a law enforcement job. Third, the bill precludes sealing while someone is on parole or, importantly, required to register as a sex offender. Because some registration periods last for life, the bill may a fortiori exclude many sex offenders already. Lastly, I want to confirm what my fellow panelists just said, that I've heard concerns about the law's effect on DNA records. As I read the bill, I do not read the bill to require the removal of DNA records from the state database. My time's up, so I just want to thank you for your time. I'm grateful to the committee for holding this hearing and to Senator Myrie for introducing such important legislation. I urge the committee and the legislature to enact this legislation this session. Thank you again.
Thank you, Mr. Grauer. The next person to testify will be Scott Levy, Chief Policy Counsel from the Bronx Defenders. Scott, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Chair Bailey and members of the Codes Committee and Senator Myrie for your championing this bill. Again, my name is Scott Levy and I am Chief Policy Counsel at the Bronx Defenders and will be testifying today in strong support of the Clean Slate Act. As my fellow panelists mentioned, the Data Collaborative for Justice at John Jay College recently released a comprehensive report on criminal convictions in New York City between 1980 and 2019. The findings underscore why Clean Slate is so critical right now. Between 1980 and 2019, the NYPD made 10.8 million arrests in New York City, largely driven by a broken windows policing strategy that aggressively employed stops and arrests for low-level offenses as its primary enforcement and surveillance tools. Arrests citywide increased from approximately 150,000 in 1980 to consistently hovering around 300,000 per year between 1995 and 2015. Many years, those arrests, which disproportionately impacted the city's low-income communities of color, resulted in more than 100,000 individual criminal convictions per year. In all, these arrests resulted in over 3.3 million individual criminal convictions, affecting almost 750,000 people in the city, the overwhelming majority of whom are Black and Latinx men. The destructive legacy of broken windows policing has saddled hundreds of thousands of people in New York City with walking life sentences. The Bronx Defenders represents approximately 20,000 people a year in criminal, family, immigration, and civil proceedings. Every day, our advocates in the civil action practice see the persistent and daunting obstacles our clients face as the result of these convictions. People with criminal convictions face a lifetime of barriers to stable employment, housing, and the resources that would allow them to thrive. Indeed, the Bronx Defenders has identified hundreds of enmeshed civil consequences in New York alone. And a national inventory of collateral consequences has cataloged at least 44,000 civil consequences nationwide. In the housing context, criminal records may permanently exclude our clients from public housing or render them ineligible for housing altogether. Private landlords regularly deny applications of our clients with criminal convictions out of hand. As a result, people end up seeking informal, often unstable housing arrangements. This instability, in turn, leads to greater difficulty in finding and holding a steady job, supporting a family, obtaining healthcare or education, and ultimately avoiding re-entry into the criminal legal system. Many of our clients are simply left homeless, living on the street or in the city's shelter system, which all too often takes people even farther away from permanent, stable housing and exposes them to overcrowding, poor sanitation, health risks, and violence. It separates families and exacerbates cycles of criminalization and poverty. Our clients face similar challenges with employment. Private employers regularly reject our clients without providing an explanation, and criminal background checks trigger automatic denials, suspensions, or revocations of our clients' jobs or occupational licenses. This perpetual punishment reaches beyond our clients, to their families who struggle alongside them, and to entire communities, contributing to high rates of poverty, unemployment, and housing instability. The legacy of over-policing and the millions of criminal convictions it's left in its wake undermine basic community health and resilience, leaving communities like the South Bronx particularly vulnerable to crises like the COVID-19 pandemic. Indeed, the Bronx, the borough with the highest proportion of people of color, has been slowest to recover jobs lost to the pandemic in recent months compared to the rest of the city. In June 2020, just months into the COVID-19 pandemic, unemployment in the Bronx hit a shocking 24.7%, by far the highest rate in the city, with Black and Latinx people most likely to have experienced wage loss. 8 out of the 10 zip codes with the highest rates of evictions filings since March 2020 are in the Bronx. They are also, not coincidentally, some of the zip codes hardest hit by COVID-19. Our clients with criminal convictions are part of this story. Their convictions not only prevent them from securing safe and stable housing and employment, but also make them and their communities more vulnerable to major economic shocks and public health emergencies. Clean Slate will provide meaningful, automatic sealing and expungement of criminal convictions for millions of New Yorkers. It is a critical step towards repairing the harm caused by decades of over-policing and underinvestment in communities of color in the Bronx. In this moment of national reckoning, the Clean Slate Act represents an investment in the Bronx future, in its recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic, and in its resilience. And for that reason, we urge you to pass and enact the Clean Slate Act as soon as possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Levy. The next panelist will be Stephen Dunn, Senior Staff Attorney, Community Service Society of New York. Mr. Dunn, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Stephen Dunn. I am a Senior Staff Attorney at the Community Service Society of New York. Thank you very much for the opportunity to testify at this vitally important hearing. CSS is a member of the Steering Committee of Clean Slate New York. We come to this Clean Slate work from many years of advocating on behalf of clients with conviction records, through litigation, legislative and policy advocacy, and direct services. As we heard very powerfully earlier in the day, a conviction history can act as an insurmountable barrier to securing living wage employment and housing, and to full participation in the life of our city and state. Through our Next Door project, we help over 700 New Yorkers each year, working with clients from across the city to obtain, review, and correct mistakes in their rap sheets. The reentry work that we and our colleagues are engaged in has never been as necessary as it is today, because never before have conviction records been so easily accessible and widely distributed. The sale of conviction records has become big business, and this in turn has drastically changed what it means to live with a conviction record. The use and dissemination of conviction records has increased exponentially. According to recent surveys, about 94% of employers and 90% of landlords use background checks to evaluate prospective employees and tenants. This proliferation of background checks began in the immediate aftermath of the attacks of September 11th, a period when many of our civil liberties were sacrificed at the altar of public safety. Due in part to increased employer fear following the attacks, commercial background check vendors reported significant increases in business. For example, the monthly volumes of conviction checks requests to one major firm increased from about 3,000 to almost 25,000 by February 2002. The rise in background checks has continued unabated, fueled by advances in information technology that have made it easier to obtain access to conviction records. Digitized court records, online state criminal repositories, and private databases that collect public conviction records have made accessing them easier than ever before. In the past, background screeners had to send runners to courts to manually review conviction history information. Today, in many jurisdictions, everything is available instantly at the click of a button. Currently, there are approximately 2,000 background check companies doing business in the United States, with revenues exceeding $3.2 billion. Three of the largest companies alone produced 56 million background checks in a recent year. Checker, which provides background checks for companies in the gig economy, such as Uber, processed 1 million reports each month, or about 23 per minute. These staggering statistics are only going to increase as technology continues to improve and these companies continue to obtain more resources. The burden of a conviction record has been significantly increased by these industry trends. Passing a background check is now an unavoidable prerequisite to obtaining a job or securing housing. With each passing year, it has become more difficult for someone with a conviction record to obtain employment and successfully participate in the life of their own community. It is easy to imagine that someone with a 25-year-old conviction is more negatively impacted by that conviction today than they were when they were first sentenced. Thankfully, a movement has started to stem the tide of a system that prioritizes background check companies' billions in profits over the health and well-being of our communities. Increasingly, people understand that we make our communities safer when we allow people who are returning home to access stable housing and employment. Clean slate policies that automate conviction records expungement have overwhelming support across the country and the political spectrum. A recent poll shows that 70% of Americans support clean slate policies, including 66% of Republicans and 75% of Democrats. Clean slate legislation is sweeping the nation, with laws passed in Michigan, Pennsylvania, and Utah, and similar campaigns underway, including Oregon, Delaware, Texas, Louisiana, California, North Carolina, New Jersey, and Connecticut. New York has an opportunity to emerge as a national leader in this field. The Clean Slate New York Act is admittedly bold legislation, but it is appropriately scaled to the scope of the problem we have here in New York. The reality of a conviction record, and the multiplicity and severity of civil consequences that flow from that record have changed dramatically over the past couple of decades. These changes have been influenced by regressive, reactive policies that respond to fear-mongering by private background check companies concerned with profit. These companies have raked in billions while millions of New Yorkers are locked out of the economy and in a state of perpetual punishment. The Clean Slate New York Act will enable the 2.3 million New Yorkers with conviction records to access employment, housing, education, and other opportunities they need to be full participants in the community and the state's economy. I thank you very much for your time, and I urge you to pass this vitally important bill.
Thank you, Mr. Dunn. The next panelist to testify will be Sunny Joe, Staff Attorney Special Litigation Unit of the Legal Aid Society. Ms. Joe, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much for the opportunity to testify today. My name is Sunny Joe. I'm an attorney with the Legal Aid Society, and I'm part of our Case Closed project, which is a record sealing and expungement project. And it was launched in 2017 after CPL 16059 went into effect. We provide direct representation, we educate the community, and we advocate for broader legal reform. And all of our work has led us to realize that while 16059 was a well-meaning first step, as Senator Myrie and others have said today, very few people are benefiting under 16059, and eligibility under 16059 is way too limited. And ultimately, what New York State really needs is automatic expungement that is much more inclusive, and that is why we strongly support the Clean Slate Act. As Ames Grower just said, when 16059 first went into effect in 2017, it was estimated that about 600,000 people may be eligible. But why is it that only about 2,500 people, less than 0.5% of the eligible pool of people have received sealing under 16059? And as a practitioner, I believe the main reason is the application process is very complicated and difficult to manage without a lawyer. I'd like to just go through briefly the application process. First, you have to figure out, am I eligible? What exactly was I convicted of? So then you need to get your rap sheet from DCJS, and that means you have to get fingerprinted, you have to pay a fee. And once you get your rap sheet weeks or months later, you still have to figure out how to read the rap sheet. Am I actually eligible? What was I convicted of? Did I clear the 10-year period? And once you do figure out that you are eligible, you must get certificates of disposition from the courts that you were convicted from. You also need to gather additional supporting documents, such as proof of employment, school transcripts, letters of recommendation. You have to get your application notarized. Then you need to make copies of the application and serve the prosecutor. You first have to know which prosecutors to serve. It can be a local county prosecutor, but it could also be the attorney general's office. And if you're applying to seal convictions from two different counties, then you must serve both prosecutors. And you know, you have to then figure out what court do I need to send this application to. And if the prosecutor ends up opposing, then you have to have a hearing where you have to go up against the prosecutor who is a trained professional, or you have to bring an attorney, which is likely very expensive. So clearly this whole process is extremely burdensome for most people. And there are so many ways in which you can make a mistake that ultimately be that you would ultimately be denied sealing as a result. And of course there's a dollar cost and time cost involved in every step. And it also requires you to relive what is often a traumatizing, pretty much like the worst moment of your life. And having an attorney does significantly increase your likelihood of getting a good result, but if sealing is only accessible to people who can afford an attorney, then there is a huge risk of increasing the socioeconomic and racial disparities that are already in the criminal legal system. And so automating the expungement process would reduce this risk, because once you become eligible, your conviction would be expunged without you having to go through a long, complicated process, and regardless of whether you can afford to hire an attorney. Also, as many have said today, eligibility under 16059 is too limited. I think Alice Vontier said earlier that in order to be eligible, you have to have no more than two convictions. At least 10 years must have passed since the conviction or release from incarceration. And certain offenses are just not eligible, so cannot be sealed. So these limited requirements exclude hundreds of thousands of people that were victimized by years of discriminatory policing and mass incarceration. And it also leaves behind so many New Yorkers who may have gone through a period of difficulty. As Senator Bailey said earlier, substance abuse issues, mental health struggles, homelessness. We've had to turn away at the Legal Aid Society. We've had to turn away a vast majority of the people who come to us for help. About 80% of the people we have to turn away because they're just simply not eligible under the current statute. And this is also why we strongly support the Clean Slate Act. You know, when you're done with your sentence, you go through all of the hoops that the system requires of you, right? They tell you you're rehabilitated, you're ready to go back into your community. Well, then you should be allowed to lead a productive life without barriers, you know? And when a person can really meaningfully reenter society, it does reduce the likelihood of recidivism. And it not only helps that individual, but it really provides stability for the entire family. And it provides them and their future generations opportunity for a better life, you know, economic mobility. And I feel like that's really part of, you know, what we're about as America, right? The American dream. So for all of these reasons, we urge you to pass the Clean Slate Act. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Joe. The final, but certainly not the least panelist, Mr. Kingsley Rowe, forensic social worker, reentry unit, New York County Defender Services. Mr. Rowe, the floor is yours. Mr. Rowe, you are muted, so.
Sorry. My name is Kingsley Rowe. I'm a forensic social worker with NYCDS in their reentry unit. NYCDS is a public defender office in Manhattan that supports our clients leaving Frankers Island and other city jails. In 1989, I was convicted of third degree murder. In 1999, I was sentenced to 10 to 20 years in prison. I was released in 1989. I was 19 years old when I started my sentence. I was 29 when I was released. While in prison, I got my associate degree from St. Francis College. Upon release, I immediately applied to NYU and was admitted. In 2002, I graduated from NYU cum laude with a BS in computer science. And in 2006, I graduated from NYU with distinction with an MSW. Even with these prestigious degrees, a supportive family, and my unwavering determination, my criminal record was still posed a serious challenge to me finding meaningful employment. I will share two examples of this. In 1989, I lost my job. I was working at St. Luke's Hospital as a child therapist. I loved my job and they loved me. I had worked there for 2 years when I learned that OMH was requiring all staff in Article 28 clinics to be fingerprinted. I received a call from OMH stating that they had found my record. They told me I had a choice. I could resign, or they would disclose to my supervisor and colleagues at St. Luke's that I had a record, which in most likelihood would have resulted in my termination. So I resigned as opposed to being humiliating myself in front of my colleagues. In 2017, nearly three decades after my conviction, my past got caught up with me again. I had just been offered my dream job. It was a behavior intervention specialist at a charter school working with young men of color in my old neighborhood of Bedford-Stuyvesant. After accepting a conditional offer, OSPRA ran a background check and moved to rescind the job offer. I appealed. I submitted dozens of letters, affidavits, my college professors, the founder and the committee for the charter school I was being employed by. I even presented my certificate of relief of disabilities, which wasn't very helpful. None of it mattered. OSPR barred me from the job. I now hold another dream job with NYCDS, the public defender firm, but I still, and I can't understate this, I can't overstate this, I still live in fear because I never know when my criminal record is going to come back and haunt me. Now I've talked about myself, let me tell you a little bit about the people I work with. I work with NYCDS clients who are being discharged from Rikers, are serving their sentences there. Other people testified and spoke about how the Clean Slate Act will remove barriers to employment, education, and housing. But there's a human cost. I want to explain how this bill will remove barriers to hope. When clients leave jail, they're often very broken people. Of course, when they're leaving jail, they're extremely happy, you know, they're excited. However, that ends very quickly when the realities of life start to impose themselves. To be clear, by the time they come into my, picture, the clients have served their time and paid their debt to society. And yet I have to explain to them that your sentence is not really over. It's just beginning. Living life with a criminal record is like navigating a maze of booby traps and landmines and waiting at every corner. A criminal record is a scarlet letter that traps people in a cycle of shame and stigma in perpetuity. And that is increasingly demoralizing, especially to people who are already struggling. The biggest achievement of this bill is to restore optimism and encourage my clients to be forward thinking and future planning regarding their reintegration, because this is something they can buy into. In essence, it will restore hope. And that's what we are trying to accomplish. Thank you for your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rowe. Before we open it up to questions, let me just take the indulgence as the chair. As someone who has never been arrested, much less convicted of a crime, I couldn't get within two feet of NYU. And that shows the reality that people are not disposable. Simply because you have been incarcerated for an offense, for a mistake that you have made, does not mean that your life is not redeemable. And again, in fact, Mr. Rowe, I've attended some of the best public schools possible, and I could not sniff NYU. And the fact that you were able to do that is a testament to who you are, who you are is not determined by the crime that you once committed. So thank you for that testimony. It was personally touching in a way, as an individual who's grown up around a lot of people who have faced adversity similar to yours. So thank you.
I really appreciate that, Chairman Bailey. I really appreciate that. I'm not the only one. You know, there's many people who are struggling out there, you know, to make it and to make their lives better. And this, you know, their records are a hindrance. I'm from Pennsylvania. I don't qualify for Clean Slate because of the limitations on the law. You know, this law that New York State is considering would not have that barrier. So, you know, I can only give my full support for this bill. But in Pennsylvania, I would not be able to claim my record.
Well, thank you. So I will open it up to questions from the members, beginning with Senator Myrie.
Thank you, Chairman. And I want to echo just how proud and grateful I am for your testimony, Mr. Rowe. Even if I had been able to sniff NYU, I certainly would not have graduated with high honors as you did. And I'm just really blown away by your testimony and very grateful. I want to thank all of the panelists for lending your expertise to this. You know, we had previous panels with people with different levels of expertise and practitioners on the proverbial other side And, you know, I think it's important for us, as they stated, for us to hear from the people on the ground and hear from people who practice. And all of you have done that and deal with these constituencies. I want to ask one question and then just ask for a clarification. You know, we've heard sentiments, and I don't think that they are unique. I think many people have this question about what classes of offenses should be eligible and why is this so broad, and why not narrow this to apply to a smaller subset of individuals with convictions. And I'm hoping that you can speak to why you think it's important that we do go broad. And that this is this automatic relief is available to as many people as possible, regardless of within the boundaries that we've set in the bill, regardless of what those offenses might be.
I'll be happy to chime in. I don't want to sit silently. I see the clock ticking. You know, thank you for that question and thank you for your sponsorship on this, Senator. I mean, the reason that the breadth of this is important is because, as you know, Mr. Rowe just like expressed so beautifully, and you know, the client that I discussed before, like people do get convicted of things that are, you know, classified as violent felonies or do have some element of violence. But, you know, if we are to allow people to ever move past that and to have a life outside of that, the type of conviction should not ultimately matter. Once a sentence has been served and then, you know, some time has passed after that, you know, it really doesn't matter. It matters what somebody does after the fact, not the fact of the conviction. It shouldn't, there is not a type of conviction that should stain somebody for their entire life. I see Ames has his hand up, so I'm going to be quiet.
Well, I don't want to tread on your response, which I think is excellent. I would just point out that to the extent that you know, any exclusions are merited, I'd want to see them grounded in the data. And I think the data actually make a good case for fewer exclusions. If you look at data on recidivism, recidivism among people who committed violent crimes is actually relatively low, or lower than people who committed property crimes, which sort of inverts the way that we actually think about the criminal justice system. So I think that makes a case for there's a case for having the longer phase out periods that this bill has for felonies. But I think that's an adequate safeguard on its own, especially when you consider what we do know about recidivism.
Great. I think first Ms. Reiser, and then we'll kick it to you, Scott.
Thank you. I'm just gonna chime in. You know, what we are talking about is we are talking about our friends, our neighbors, family members, our colleagues in this campaign, including folks who we heard from earlier today, who have served their sentence and are returning home to their communities. So they are in their communities. These people are becoming part of our civil and economic systems again. And by depriving them of these stabilizing factors, these things that everyone needs in order to, you know, ensure they can live safely and ensure they live securely, we are very seriously compromising community safety. And I think when we talk about safety and we talk about who is benefiting from this bill, we need to like very clearly understand that the criminal legal system no longer plays a role in the lives of these people. And so not only is there a moral imperative to say that the hands of the criminal legal system should let go of these people, their role has ended, but in addition, this is the reality of people coming home to their communities. And if we don't give people the resources they need, we're not helping them, we're not helping their families, we're not helping their communities, and we're not helping New York State. And that applies irrespective of what someone's conviction history is.
And I have very little to add to that. I would say often, I think when we talk about community safety, it is presented as a zero-sum game. And I think what we have heard today so powerfully, particularly in the first panel, is that that's just not the case. Real community safety, real community health means that people are supported. People have access to opportunity, access to jobs, access to stable housing. And I think what we also heard in the first panel so powerfully is that it's not just individuals who face these barriers. It is their families. It is their children. It is their loved ones, right? And that doesn't change, as Sam just said, that doesn't change because of a person's conviction, right? If we want people to live healthy, productive, safe lives, if we want them to be able to support their children, support their families, and live without having to constantly wait for the next shoe to drop, right? To live with some stability and to make a life, right? We can't exclude people from that opportunity. And I think it's, you know, we can't think of community safety as zero sum, right? It is a holistic enterprise. We have to support and provide access to opportunity for everyone, and everyone does better when people have access.
Thank you for that. And with the chair's indulgence, I know the time is up. If it's okay, Mr. Chair, just one quick follow-up on some of the clarifications about what's in the bill and sort of what we tried to do to accommodate some of the sensitivities and sort of subsequent opportunities that people would have an opportunity to participate in. I believe it was you, Ms. Reiser, who spoke to some of the sensitivities around driving, fingerprinting, and DNA handling. And I'm just wondering if you could, just for the record, state those clarifications again so that we can have that in our record.
Definitely. So to start with driving, so the Department of Motor Vehicle keeps individual driving abstracts, which include driving-related convictions and license suspensions, among other types of information. So as currently written, this Senate bill would not require the removal of conviction information from the driving abstract. So employers considering applicants for driving-related jobs would still have access to that information on the driving abstract. And in addition, the DMV would also have that information for licensing determination. In terms of sensitive industries, you know, and I touched on this in my testimony, but this bill would interact with existing laws in very common sense ways. So there are certain jobs or licenses that the state has rightly determined require additional screening processes, and therefore they require individuals to undergo fingerprinting before they can obtain a clearance or a license to be employed in certain sensitive industries. So, you know, as was mentioned, the two-tier process contemplates the sensitivities of certain types of employment. And therefore, access to conviction records will continue at the sealing stage and will only become blocked at the expungement stage, which is when you're talking about folks who have served their sentence successfully completed all terms of community supervision. So we're talking about parole and probation, and they are not on the sex offender registry. And a minimum of 5 to 7 years has passed since their conviction, tolling for time spent incarcerated, during which they have not incurred any subsequent convictions. So when you just think about all of those eligibility criteria together, it is no easy feat to get to that point. And when an individual does get to that point, the recidivism research makes clear, as Ames explained in his testimony, that individuals are no more likely than members of the general public to be reconvicted of an offense. And I now can't remember if there's one other thing that I was supposed to clarify.
Just the DNA, but if it's okay with the chair, I don't want to take that.
Absolutely. Ms. Reiser, you make it. Please continue, followed by Senator O'Mara, who has his hand up for a question.
Definitely. So as I read the Senate Bill 1553A, there is an exhaustive list of information that is required to be expunged. That includes palm prints, fingerprints, retina scans, and mugshots. However, it does not include DNA information. And I will also flag that there are other sections of the law that govern the retention of DNA information. And as written, this bill does not in any way amend those sections of the law. Thank you.
Senator O'Mara, followed by Senator Kavanaugh. Senator O'Mara, you have the floor.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, my mic's on. I just got two questions, really. We're putting this burden of all the sealing and expungement upon the district attorney's offices. Why not put that on public defenders and legal aid societies to undertake that role as the representation of the client. You know, as you said, they need assistance by attorneys through the current process of the 16059, but why would it not be more appropriate for this work to be handled by the public defenders?
I'm happy to try to take a stab at that. I don't think that this bill actually puts the burden of doing the work of clean slate on prosecutors and district attorney's offices. The automatic mechanism that is in this bill actually, I think, takes a lot of that work outside of the district attorney's offices. Of course, there will be record keeping, you know, obligations, but those record keeping obligations are things that in theory they are already doing, right? Having to sort of keep certain files separate from other files for particular purposes. But the actual mechanisms of sealing and expungement will take place outside of prosecutors' offices. And I think that is actually one of the most critical pieces of this legislation.
Anyone else?
Yeah, I'll just add that that's my understanding as well. I think the DCJS plays a big role here, but in other jurisdictions that have automatic sealing and expungement laws, the burden of like automating the process is usually done by some third party actor. So I think that's right. Like there would be, you know, I'm a former prosecutor. I think there would be some incidental work to be done in a prosecutor's office, but I think the bulk of it would be done external to the prosecutors as well.
Okay. There was some discussion from some of the witnesses here on this panel, and I thank you all for your input on this. With regards to, you know, what's out there on the internet, the World Wide Web, a lot of this stuff is never going to disappear out there, regardless of what sealing and expungement gets done through this statute. Any thoughts on how that should be dealt with going forward?
I can actually speak to that in a limited extent. This is actually where some of the more recent economic research on sealing and expungement is really heartening, because you hit on a really valid point. Like the internet is forever to some extent. It will be hard to completely wash a record out of public view entirely. But what the research shows is that sealing expungement does work, even with that information living on in some form. The research paper that I think some of us have spoken about is Prescott and Starr, two law professors, writing in, I think, the Harvard Law Review and their Michigan law professors. But they find really strong impacts from sealing statutes in Michigan, despite knowing that those records will still be available. So I don't have an answer, and I think it'd be I think it's a very, very important question, like how to address the broader availability of information. But sealing does seem to work even with that very real concern you identify.
Thank you for that. And one final question for the panel. After expungement of a conviction, on a subsequent conviction, and I'm talking really expungement of more serious crime, whether it's a violent crime or something of that effect, and another crime occurs after the expungement of that, shouldn't the court have access to that prior criminal conviction and aspects of it in making sentencing determinations on the new charge, even though it's after the expungement of the former?
I'm happy to take a stab at that. This bill I think makes clear that things like predicate sentencing, predicate felony sentencing, and bump up charges, you know, charges that are premised on or predicated on a prior conviction, those provisions are exempted from the expungement. So, predicate felony sentencing, bump up charges would remain intact and access for those specific purposes built into the law.
But there will be situations where somebody was convicted of armed robbery, they serve their time, they do their post incarceration period, and they do their 7 years, and they get that expunged. How is the court going to be aware of that in a subsequent conviction and sentencing situation?
So, I think the very short answer is that, you know, why do they need to be? If somebody has served their time, several years have passed, that is sealed and gone, it's expunged, and another conviction happens, what impact should that prior action have on the sentence? If it doesn't qualify as a predicate felony or doesn't qualify, if it's so old that under our law you can't use it to enhance a sentence, then it shouldn't be relevant at all. The current conduct is what the court should be looking at in sentencing.
Well, I would strongly disagree with that and think that those types of prior convictions should be able to be utilized by the court in sentencing going forward, regardless of depending on the seriousness of that prior conviction and the conduct alleged in the current one is extremely relevant to what sentence a judge will impose within the range of applicable sentencing, regardless of whether it's a predicate basis or not.
And our current laws are quite expansive on a second felony offense, a predicate felony, any discretionary sentences. They're very expansive, and this, and again, as Scott said, this law would not impact that. So you're talking about a very small amount of cases anyway.
I hate to monopolize. I think these are really good points, and Senator, this is a really good question. I just want to add my understanding. As I understand it, the law does permit prosecutors and courts to access expunged records for to establish a predicate felony. It's upon ex parte application. To the extent the law is unclear, I think maybe that could be clarified. But you raise a really good question about like how would a prosecutor even know that there are records to access? The way I read the statute, those files would get a big expunge stamp on them, but still be in the jacket. So if I were like the felony prosecutor, I get the case box delivered to my desk, and in it is a file jacket that says expunged. And you know, I can look at it, I just can't use it in court until I make an ex parte application. I, of course, welcome correction from any of the people on the panel if I'm reading it wrongly, but that's my understanding at least.
Now, what's the effective difference between stealing and expungement?
The need to make the application. In a sealed conviction record, you wouldn't have to make the application. You could just reference it as a predicate felony in court. If it's expunged, you would have to first make an ex parte motion to the judge to ask for the permission to use the record. Again, as I read it, I could be wrong.
Okay.
Thank you. It's a good question.
Thank you. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Senator O'Mara. Thank you, everybody, for answering. Senator Kavanaugh, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you to this panel. I particularly take I'll just note that Ames is a former colleague from my office in the assembly, so it's great to see you, Ames. And just a couple of questions. First of all, thank you all for tremendous expertise and as strong supporters of this bill. I want to just, given that we've had panels of people who are distinguished in their fields, but also skeptics of this, I want to just ask, is there anything if you had the opportunity to view or review prior testimony during this hearing, anything that you heard that you would consider, a friendly amendment or clarification to this bill from the prosecutors, from the police?
Don't all jump in at once.
I'm happy to jump
in. You can say you didn't like any of it. That's a perfect, very legitimate answer. But
well, I think that several clarifications were already made around the use of records for insensitive industries, for licensing and clearancing purposes, as well as driving-related convictions, as well as DNA retention. I think those are the three big ones. I feel like other members of this panel have eloquently explained why it's really critical that we not exclude certain types of convictions from this legislation, and that 1553A remain a very broad and expansive bill. The one other thing that I would like to highlight is I think folks in the second panel talked a bit about sort of ways in which criminal procedure law 160.59, which is the current application-based stealing law, could be tinkered to make it more effective. And I just really want to emphasize, and this is something that Clean Slate member Sunny Joe said in her testimony, when that law went into effect in 2017, it was believed that 600,000 people would be eligible. In the more than 3 years since it has been in effect, less than 2,500 people have benefited, which comes out to less than 0.5% of the group of people who are believed to be eligible. And this isn't because of, you know, lack of awareness, lack of a public education campaign. Those are some of the issues at play with 16059. But the vast majority of you know, reasons why this bill has not benefited the number of people it should be is because it's way too restrictive. So we can tinker at the edges with it, but it won't make any real meaningful reform. That is why automation is so critical, and that's why we need bold and, you know, progressive policy like this bill. The one other thing I will say about 16059 is, and this is where I will bring in a client anecdote. I have represented dozens of individuals and their applications for sealing under this law. I will say the process takes quite a while for myself, and I am an attorney. Figuring out eligibility can be difficult. And again, you know, I went to law school for 3 years. I'm in the practice of law. So you can only imagine how difficult this might be for folks who sort of, who don't have the same access to legal expertise. But in addition to all of the complexities of the law, it also is a very protracted process. The steps that you have to go through to even file take a while, but because of administrative backlog, these processes, these applications can languish in the court for months and sometimes years. I have one client who I've been representing since December of 2018, and he is still waiting for a decision on his application. I call the court, I'd say every 2 weeks, and we have yet to get a decision on his case. In the meantime, he's only, you know, he does not have full-time employment. He calls me, I speak to him probably every month or so because he's very anxious about applying for employment until his record has been sealed. So we talk about sort of how 16059 hasn't benefited the, you know, the people who it intended to benefit, but there's also an element of sort of burdens on the court system that we're not appreciating that automation would also solve for. And I think that's another reason why any sort of tinkering and sort of bolstering of an application-based system won't have the intended effect that relief of this type needs to have.
I want to note that you very effectively demonstrated your effectiveness as an advocate there by turning my question about whether there was anything you agreed with into a very, you know, articulate explanation of why those people are mistaken. So that was impressive. Anybody on the panel? Let me just pluck one example. One of our prosecutors said that if you're looking at an expungement decision, it might be worth considering whether somebody has committed a recent crime during the period in a neighboring state. I mean, does that sound like something that is least worth exploring?
I'll speak to that briefly. And Senator, thank you for the shout out. It's great to see you as well. I think that's a really interesting idea. The question that comes to me and is sort of implementation. I'm not quite sure how that would work. Perhaps it's worth exploring, but given the sort of, we know criminal record databases, even the FBI's have significant errors in them. I think it'd be difficult to do effectively, but and I'm not going to commit myself on the record to saying to endorsing it yet, but I think it could be worth exploring to make sure, but it'd have to be done delicately, I think, given the limitations of criminal record information.
Now, I will also share that the other states that have passed clean state legislation laws, including Utah, Pennsylvania, and Michigan, do not consider out-of-state convictions because the implementability would sort of compromise the ability to have that kind of legislation.
To do it efficiently.
Yep.
And if I may, I actually don't see the clocks. I don't know how far I am in here. Can I ask you just one more aspect? I think the NYPD testified to, they had a couple specific examples of things they wanted to retain information for, like, you know, photos for lineups and other things. But I read their testimony as basically saying it would be good if police continue to have more or less open-ended records of access to these records, even if other parties don't. Anyone comment on the desirability of, you know, of ensuring that that's not the case? Or let me make it a more neutral question. Any reactions to that that thought?
I suppose I will reemphasize that. Oh, Scott, you were about to speak. I was going to say, as Sam pointed out, DNA does remain available, as I understand it. And I know that was one of their concerns. And I think the point about needing DNA for innocence proceedings is, I think, a pretty interesting point that's definitely worth thinking about. So thank you for that question, Senator. And I'll yield to Scott. Sorry.
Yeah. Thanks.
I would just say, I do think that meaningful and real deep expungement for folks is really, really important, right? We heard so much about sort of access to housing and employment and those types of things, but we also heard about just sort of the psychological impact of the community, of like society saying, you are a full member, right? And that means that the police don't see you as an automatically see you as a suspect anymore, right? And that is a deeply important, I think, value too. And I think it is hard to quantify, and that's why it is difficult. You know, we don't have statistics or reports to cite on that fact, but I think the testimony on the first panel in particular, but I think those of us who practice and represent clients know that the psychological weight of that is not insignificant, and that true meaningful sort of acceptance and reentry requires an actual clean slate, right? And needs to actually reach people at that level as well.
Great. Okay, there's nothing further. I yield my time back. Thank you. And I just want to emphasize that I asked this in the spirit of allowing dialogue to occur, since you're not here at the same time to talk to each other. I'm not necessarily asking you about your acceptance of views that I espouse, to say the least. So, but thank you all.
Thank you, Senator Kavanaugh. Seeing no further questions, Senator Meyer, do you have a second round?
No, I think Scott answered it mostly. I was just going to comment on the sort of concern expressed by the NYPD that not having sort of unfettered access to this will prevent them in a situation where there's a quote-unquote live investigation happening. And they think that having access to these records might help with securing the safety of a victim. You know, I think that's a concern that we're going to have to sort of grapple with and talk about. But I think sort of Scott answered that question.
Okay. So seeing no further questions, I'd like to thank you all for your time and your dedication to the clean slate. Thank you for answering the questions. And I'm sure we will certainly be in further contact and discussions related to these matters and other matters as the session winds down. Thank you all for your time. The next panel will be related to labor. And we have Shai Green, I hope I don't mispronounce the name, from Laborers Local 79. And Rebecca Miller, the Deputy Legislative and Political Director of CWA, Communication Workers of America, District 1. So, Ms. Green, you are first. And please, I do apologize if I pronounced your name incorrectly.
You got it right the second time. It's Shai Green.
Shai. Okay. I was just making sure. You are on the clock.
Thank you. So good afternoon, and thank you for the opportunity to testify. For the first time maybe ever dealing with the state in relation to criminal justice, I feel like this is a safe place to open this Pandora's box and share our stories. I want to first take this time to acknowledge all the testimonies before mine. I'm so grateful to share this space with you all. Our stories need to be told. Thank you for your bravery. My name is Shai Green, and I'm a member of the Laborers of Local 79 and an employee with Pathways to Apprenticeship, a nonprofit organization dedicated to training and placing justice-involved individuals into unionized construction careers. I grew up affected by the justice system, raised by two incarcerated parents from prison. My father served a lifetime sentence due to his suicide in 2018. Though he was released in 2009, he was never able to re-enter the community and be a productive member to his community, his children, or himself. Similarly to my dad, upon my release, it was extremely difficult to find employment. Unlike my dad, I was a college graduate, articulate, well-mannered, and emotionally prepared to re-enter society, but I couldn't even get a job at Radio Shack. Eventually, I was recruited by a non-union plumbing contractor who exploited my record by paying me less than what they originally offered and pressured me to do dangerous work. I was constantly threatened with termination if I did not continue to take on these dangerous tasks, which would put me in a position to violate my supervision and have my kids placed back in the foster care system that I grew up in. Local 79 laborers gave me a second chance. This career opportunity was my only understanding of a clean slate. Union construction has lifted people of color, specifically justice-affected workers, out of the system of recidivism. But not when employers are feeding off cycles of poverty and incarceration, which is exactly what body shops do. Body shops in the construction industry coerce workers to do dangerous jobs for little pay with no benefits. I heard a lot of testimony today about the possibility of reoffending, and from my personal experience and plenty of research, it's clear that reentry workers face barriers from employment, housing, and education, so we take the jobs that we can get. Body shop employers know this and rely upon reentry workers for their workforce because they know that these workers have to maintain employment. Most people don't understand how your history can follow you. After joining Local 79, I had the opportunity to become an instructor with Pathways to Apprenticeship, where we would enter Rikers Island and present reentry union building trades opportunities. After 2 years of success and established real reentry opportunities, the facility restricted me and other justice-involved instructors from continuing due to our criminal records. We were the only organization providing rehabilitation that the justice system claims to be seeking. Employers like body shops should not be able to use a person's record to suppress wage and safety standards. Reentry workers deserve a clean slate. I've personally pled guilty to charges I didn't deserve because my record already prevented me from being a true member of the community, and that's something that plagues many reentry people. I've sat in courtrooms in front of district attorneys who could have helped me, but instead reminded the courts of my prior record. Though I was almost 10 years free of any criminal charges, and I personally saw how hard they fought just to get a win under their belt, with no regard to how I'd continue to be affected by ridiculous charges that for those with no prior justice record would be considered a mistake. As a felon, I'm not in the position to make mistakes like using the wrong ID during a routine traffic stop. When I made this mistake, I found myself sitting in a courtroom on eluding charges. This is after being out of trouble for almost over a decade. District Attorney Kennedy made a comment about helping reentry people become better citizens. With all due respect, District Attorney Kennedy, we don't need help becoming better citizens. We need the opportunity to be treated as citizens. When my fiance was released from federal prison, though we had been together almost 14 years, engaged in no criminal activities together, and I had a powerful influence on the current state of reentry, he was not allowed to be released to me. The issues that reentry individuals face exceed the surface conversations of the lifetime punishments that we are all aware of. These paper trails ruin families and destroy self-esteems. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Green. I will come back to you with the commentary about that powerful testimony in a minute, but we're going to go to our next panelist, Becca Miller, Deputy Legislative and Political Director from CWA. Becca, the floor is yours.
Hello, thank you so much. Good to be with all of you this afternoon. My name is Becca Miller. I'm the Deputy Legislative and Political Director for the Communications Workers of America, District 1. I definitely want to start by thanking the chairman and the committee members for having me here today. I also want to thank Senator Myrie for his leadership on this critical piece of legislation. And lastly, I want to thank all the panelists before me who have shared their experiences and their expertise. CWA District 1 represents more than 145,000 workers belonging to nearly 200 locals. Our members work in telecommunications, healthcare, higher education, manufacturing, broadcast, and cable television, commercial printing, newspapers, state and local and county governments. Nationally, CWA represents over 500,000 workers in all of these industries. We strongly support passing the Clean Slate legislation, S-1553A, filed by Senator Myrie. This is important legislation that would automatically expunge a person's conviction history after completing all supervision and a period of time with no new convictions. This is fair and reasonable. Expunging conviction history should be made as accessible as possible in order to improve outcomes for people with records and, as the data show, without risks and even benefits to community safety. Without this legislation, fellow New Yorkers will continue to face unjust, significant barriers to employment, housing, healthcare, higher education, and much more because of conviction history. The systemic discrimination undermines our ability to move forward and build safe and stable lives. Furthermore, because of our criminal justice system, which disproportionately impacts Black and Brown communities all the way from stop and arrest through post-sentencing, this injustice of forever living with the stigma and barriers of a conviction history also disproportionately impacts those same communities. A recent study showed that Black and Latino people make up nearly 80% of the individuals in New York City with conviction records, despite only accounting for 55% of the population. We see this statewide as well. This compounds racial inequities that already exist in employment and housing opportunities across the state. The impact of this injustice is not felt by them alone, but reverberates across families and communities. Almost 50% of children in the US have at least one parent with a criminal record. But people who serve carceral sentences lose almost $500,000 in wages over their lifetime. This loss in earnings worsens economic disparities for them and their families. However, we have an opportunity to fix this with clean slate legislation. A 2019 study on the impact of expungement, and I think we heard about this study before, you know, found that within 2 years of an individual clearing their record under Michigan law, their wages increased by 25%. This is seriously a matter of both racial and economic justice. It's a meaningful step forward in our fight for both of those things. Under the current ceiling law, fewer than 0.5% of eligible individuals have been able to successfully clear their records. This likely means it's not working. This is because application-based record clearing is costly, confusing, and burdensome. Automatic expungement ensures that everyone who's eligible gets to have it, regardless of their ability to navigate complex bureaucratic systems, obtain counsel, and afford the process. It's good public policy. We know that people need housing, education, and employment to stabilize their lives and successfully return to their communities. Our policies should be supporting that and incentivizing that. Instead, our current system ensures that fellow New Yorkers are forced into struggle and economic insecurity, which can increase recidivism and undermine public safety goals. And the data shows this. This is about racial and economic justice and increasing community safety. I urge the committee to support this important legislation. Thanks so much for your time and consideration.
Thank you, Ms. Miller. And before I open it up to some questions, I just want to go back and one, thank you both for your testimony. And Ms. Green, I want to highlight and illustrate something that you said and expound further upon it based upon some of the other things that we've tackled in our house. When you mentioned taking pleas for things that you know you didn't do so that you may advance your way through the justice system, it's something that I think some people don't fully grasp that it actually happens. And not only does it happens far too often. It's a shame, actually, one. And secondly, it puts you in a position where it's another conviction on your record and another thing that you have to prove yourself to someone who doesn't even know who you are or what your character is. And I think that is one of the finer points that I want to illustrate in this hearing, there are individuals who not only make mistakes, but there are mistakes that they're accused of, they didn't make, but it is easier for them to accept responsibility for something that they did not do than to fight through it and risk something worse at the end. So I just wanted to make sure we illustrate that. And that is something that has happened. And again, not pointing out any specific individual or any, but it's happening in 5 boroughs and it's happening in 62 counties. And it's not something that is unique, sadly enough, to you, Ms. Green. So I wanted to, one, thank you for bringing that up and also commend you for not giving up when you so easily, quite frankly, could have based upon the testimony that you've given. I will defer to the sponsor of legislation for further questions.
Yeah, I would, thank you, Mr. Chair. I would just add to that. I don't really have questions. I really want to thank both of you for your testimony, Ms. Green. Thank you for sharing your personal story, which is, it's a painful thing to hear. So I can't imagine what it is to live and to have to retell that. And we appreciate you being willing to do that. And Becca, thank you for speaking on behalf of labor and just how important it is, both of you, that this isn't, this is the moral thing to do. It's the right thing to do. It's the fair thing to do, the just thing to do. But there's a lot of exploitation that happens around this in the labor market. And that is something that I think needs to be highlighted, that not only are people being prevented from opportunities, but the opportunities that they're afforded, people are exploiting their records after they've served their time. And I think it speaks to how willing people are to just be engaged in economic activity to survive, that they're willing to undergo that type of exploitation because of what has happened in their past. And so I want to thank both of you for taking the time to come and to testify today.
Thank you, Senator Marty. Senator Kavanaugh.
I'll also just be brief and add my thanks again, particularly to Ms. Green for, you know, sharing your personal story, and to both of you for, and I will note again, Becca Miller is also a former colleague from my assembly office, which I think we're developing evidence that maybe I've been in office for too long since all these marvelous people have moved on to bigger and better things for my office. But I do want to say, like, both of you are working with labor organizations that really have taken an important role, and not just, I think there's a perception that unions are often sort of protecting the narrow interest of their workers and like pushing for the highest wages in a given contract or with a given employer. But I think, you know, both of you working organizations that really have taken a broader view of a lot of big social issues, and especially taken steps to protect people with, you know, greater challenges than many of us can even imagine. So I really do appreciate your testimony and both of your personally and your organizations getting behind this legislation. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Kavanaugh. I also want to outline that there are some, there have been other pieces of legislation that we can speak about in another forum that I've introduced, that other members have introduced as well, relating to the real reentry or in the reentry process. When we're looking to actually rehabilitate individuals, we should give them an actual path to prosperity as opposed to simply a theoretical one, which is also often riddled with landmines and traps along the way. The chicken or the egg is kind of what keeps coming up with these situations when these individuals are happening. But Ms. Green and Becca, thank you so much for your time and for your attention to this. And if there's nothing further, we can go to the sixth and final panel. So ladies, thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you so much. Take care.
The sixth and final panel. I think that there are a couple of people who have who were in the green room, but they've dropped in. If we can get them back on, we will certainly add them. But as of right now, we have Claire Dorfman of State and Local Government Relations she's the Northeast Manager, of State and Local Government Relations of JPMorgan Chase & Company. And so, Claire, thank you for showing up. If we can reset the clock to 5 minutes so that Ms. Dorfman can start her testimony. And the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Codes Committee Chair Bailey, Senator Myrie, bill sponsor, and committee members. My name is Claire Dorfman, and I'm here from JPMorgan Chase, proudly one of the largest employers and contributors to the economy of the state of New York. I am submitting testimony today in support of Clean Slate legislation, which would implement automatic record expungement in New York State. One in three Americans has an arrest or conviction record that can significantly impact their ability to get a job, housing, or an education. As you've heard many times today, the petition-based expungement system is costly, it's complicated, and time-consuming. In New York State, more than 600,000 people are eligible to have their records sealed, but very few pursue this complex process. This means that even after fulfilling their justice system obligations, people with criminal records often continue to be blocked from fully participating in the economy and their community. The drag on the earning potential of tens of millions of Americans are costs not only borne by individuals and their families and their communities, but also have larger economic consequences to business and society. A recent Brennan Center report stated that the average person with a conviction misses out on roughly $100,000 in earnings over the course of a career. Someone who is imprisoned as a young adult, regardless of the offense, suffers an average of $484,000 lost earnings. As you know, this issue disproportionately affects people of color. Three quarters of New York State's formerly imprisoned population is Black or Latinx. Clean Slate legislation can help to change this. As we continue to recover from the pandemic, businesses are now adapting to economic conditions and resuming their search for skilled workers. By reducing barriers to employment for those with criminal records, we will be able to get more people back to work quickly. JPMorgan Chase is committed to giving people across the country a second chance. In the past, we have provided comments to the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, better known as FDIC, on proposed modifications to Section 19 to narrow the circumstances under which the FDIC's written consent is required to hire individuals with minor criminal offenses. Recent revisions to Section 19 have helped ease these restrictions, but more can be done. In 2020, JPMorgan Chase hired more than 2,100 people with criminal backgrounds. 2,100 people. That's about 10% of new hires in the United States. These people had, their history had no bearing on the requirements of the job that they were seeking. And with a workforce of more than 30,000 people here in New York State, the firm is always in need of top talent to fill open positions. Finally, just last week, JPMorgan Chase joined a group of 30 companies, many that are based here in New York, to launch the Second Chance Business Coalition, proudly chaired by our chairman and CEO, Jamie Dimon. The coalition aims to expand hiring and advancement practices for people with criminal records within their companies. If implemented, Clean Slate will help bolster the state's economy by more fully tapping the talents of thousands of people who are currently unemployed or underemployed because of their criminal record. When someone cannot get their foot in the door to compete for a job, it hurts the business and the communities by limiting access to economic opportunity. The benefits of automatic expungement are clear, and we urge the New York State Legislature to pass this legislation. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you, Ms. Dorfman, for your testimony. Senator Myrie.
Thank you, Ms. Dorfman. I think it's, one, we're very grateful for your testimony, but a testament to the economic impact that this bill would have, that we would have the support of JPMC. And yeah, I'm grateful for the work that you're doing with individuals that have conviction records. And I think you already sort of spoke to this in your written and public testimony, in that it is in our best interest to include as many people in the process as possible. And in your own experience and in the firm's own experience, the individuals that they've hired have been just as capable as individuals without conviction records. And it's important to have a firm of your stature be able to say that publicly. And so we're very grateful for that testimony.
Thank you very much. We appreciate it. Again, we see this as a major tool towards a more inclusive economy and happy to be here. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Myrie. Senator Kavanaugh.
Sorry, I actually just had not dropped my hand, but I'll just echo the sentiments of Senator Myrie to say it is terrific to hear, you know, your support for this and also the work you've done proactively to hire folks. So thank you for that since my hand is inadvertently raised.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you, Senator Kavanaugh. Ms. Dorfman, I'd also like to thank you for your testimony. And I think when it comes down to it, you mentioned something, you outlined something that is critical to think about. Individuals who may happen to have a conviction. I'd venture to say that there is no way for us to be able to look at someone and determine whether that individual had a conviction or not. And it is about the quality of the work that companies like JPMorgan Chase are more concerned about, as opposed to the mistakes that have been made in the past. And I think that's a fair assessment from your written in the oral testimony that you've given. So I just really want to say thank you for your testimony. And so we had two other individuals, and I wanted to make sure we thank them. I think via scheduling conflicts or internet matters. Actually, I'm told that both other members of the panel are coming in. So Ms. Dorfman, if you'd like to stick around, you certainly can. But we do have Rabbi Hilly Haber, the Director of Social Justice Organizing and Education from Central Synagogue, and Cecilia Gentile, the Project Managing Consultant of the New Pride Agenda. They will both be coming on. And I'm glad that they're joining us. So Rabbi Haber, the floor, please reset the clock to 5 minutes. And the floor is yours, Rabbi.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much to the committee and to you, Senator Bailey. It's such an honor to be here. Thank you so much for hearing my testimony. My name is Rabbi Hilly Haber, and I am the Director of Social Justice Organizing and Education at Central Synagogue. I would like to thank the Senate Standing Committee on Codes for the opportunity to submit written testimony on the urgent need to pass Clean Slate legislation. In partnership with advocates, activists, and other faith-based institutions and organizations, Central Synagogue has advocated on behalf of several criminal justice reform bills, including Raise the Age, bail reform, and parole reform. My remarks today will address the tremendous value of criminal records clearance and why New York must pass Senate Bill 1553A, which would automatically expunge a person's conviction history after their completion of all supervision and a period of time with no new convictions. As you've already heard, today 2.3 million of our fellow New Yorkers face significant barriers because of their conviction records. Rather than having access to the very opportunities they need to succeed, steady employment, safe housing, healthcare, and education, they battle systemic discrimination that undermines their ability to move forward in their lives. This impact is not felt by them alone, however, but also reverberates across their families and communities. Almost 50% of children in the United States have at least one parent with a criminal record. But people who serve carceral sentences lose almost $500,000 in wages over their lifetime. This loss in earnings worsens economic disparities for them and their families. Further, the impact of a conviction record is disproportionately felt by Black and Brown communities because of systemic racism in our criminal legal system. According to one recent study between 1990 and 2019, Black and Latinx people made up just nearly 80% of the individuals in New York City with conviction records, despite accounting for just 55% of the population. Statewide trends are similar, compounding the racial inequities that already exist in unemployment and housing opportunities across the state. By passing the Clean Slate Act, New York would have the opportunity to right this racial injustice and ensure New Yorkers have meaningful opportunities to move beyond their conviction records. Further, a conviction history can erect a lasting barrier to economic security and full engagement in the community, affecting not only individual families, but also neighborhoods and New York State as a whole. In the Jewish community, we would frame this as a perpetual exile, an exile from which you are not allowed to return, even when you have come home. Our economy loses $87 billion in gross domestic product every year from shutting workers with records out of the labor market, and people who serve time in prison lose an average of nearly $500,000 in earnings over their lifetime. Perpetual punishment and unending exile are foreign concepts in Jewish tradition. Unlike our criminal legal system in New York and in states across the country, punishment is neither permanent nor an end in itself according to Jewish law and ethics. The purpose of punishment in Jewish tradition is teshuva, repentance, atonement, and a full return home with a clean slate. This is how communities thrive and flourish, our Jewish sages teach us, when people are able to return and fully participate. For too long, a criminal conviction has served as a civil life sentence in New York. It is time for our state to rectify this harm by passing Clean Slate Act. States as varied as Pennsylvania, Utah, and Michigan have already passed Clean Slate legislation, and campaigns are underway nationwide, including in Oregon, Delaware, Texas, and California. It is time for New York to not just join this national movement, but to be a real leader in it. At Central, we thank Senator Myrie for his sponsorship and the code Senators Bailey, Benjamin, Biagi, Brisbois, and Cooney for their co-sponsorship. As a Jewish community, we at Central are in the business of forgiveness and compassion, not unending punishment and permanent exile. Our organization looks forward to working with the Standing Committee on Codes and the rest of the Senate membership to bring this important legislation to New York. Thank you so much for having me here today. It is an honor to speak on behalf of this legislation and to ensure that all of New York has what it needs to thrive.
Thank you greatly, Rabbi, for your testimony. And the next person to testify will be Cecilia Gentile, the project managing consultant of the New Pride Agenda. Ms. Gentile, the floor is yours. Reset the clock to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you so much for having me today. I was the last one in the list, so I thought I would go like 10 p.m. at night. So I'm glad that that was not the case, like last time I testified, though. So thank you. And thank you to the rabbi for such a like beautiful rendition to learn about what it means, what atoning means in in his fate. So my name is Cecilia Gentili. I'm working as a manager for the new Pride Agenda, and I am a transgender woman. I am an immigrant. I live in this country undocumented for 10 of my 22 years, and I engage in sex work for 30 years of my life, and I use substances for 20 years of my life. As you know, many of those, actually most of those parts of my identity are criminalized. You know, the sex work is a crime in the state of New York. Using drugs comes with a lot of criminalization. Being a trans person comes with a lot of extra steps that brings to criminalization. You know, sometimes until a couple of months ago, I could not be standing up in the corner because the police could come and arrest me for loitering for purposes of prostitution. You know, we work really hard to take, you know, to change that. And I am very happy that that did change in the state of New York. And, you know, throughout my history, I endured so many encounters with law enforcement that they were just because of who I am, because of what my identity is. Is it because I'm a trans person? Is it because I'm a woman? Is it because I'm undocumented? Is it because I use drugs? Is it because I am a sex worker? So throughout many years, I have a long record, right? So 10 years ago, I went to treatment. I got my act together. I got clean. I got an asylum in this country, and I had an internship at the LGBT Center, and everybody wanted to hire me. Everybody wanted to hire me. And I did not apply for any jobs for about a year just because of one reason. It was that I didn't know how I was going to address my history of arrest. So I had an opportunity to have a clean slate, and I was not able to do it because I stopped myself, because I knew that this record was this heavy burden in my back, and I did not want to go apply for a job and then, because of that record, not get it. You know, disappointment has been part of my life since I realized that I was a queer kid. You know, I faced disappointment so many times in my life. I did not want to be disappointed by, you know, having the illusion that I could get an opportunity and a chance to have a job. And then when I get it, because of my record, not be able to have it. And I sweat bullets when it was like, you have to make a mark. Do you have a record? I was sweating when they asked me that. And I went to my interview and I said, I want you all to know that I do have a record. And they were like really nice people. And they said, we will work around it. We really want you here. We really want you as a trans person, as an undocumented person, as a person who uses drugs and as a sex worker, because all of those identities are of value to us, because you are an expert of who you are, and we need you here. And for all of that, we will work around it. But what I wanted to say is that I was one of those 2.3 million, and many, many people in my community are in the same situation, and they're ready to go back to society and to do what they have to do to make their living, and they're not able to do it because of their records. So yes, this is the perfect time to have a clean slate for everybody in New York State. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your testimony, Ms. Gentili. I truly appreciate both of your testimony, both from a compelling personal perspective and triumphing against adversity, and Rabbi, for, you know, a spiritual centering as it were. Sometimes it's important for us to recognize that as whole individuals, and I think that's what the first panel, that's what we led with, speaking about whole individuals. I think it's important to recognize that an individual's humanity is not tied to just their religion or just who who they are, just their career or what they may have done. It is a totality of circumstance based approach that that we should be there. So I don't really have any question. I just wanted to, it was just more in thanks of your strength and your testimony. And I will defer to Senator Myrie. Senator Myrie.
Yeah, I don't have questions, but would likewise want to express my gratitude. Thank you, Rabbi, for your testimony. And I think regardless of your faith, you know, the concept of redemption is something that we all can understand and we all can appreciate. And I'm grateful that you were able to bring that perspective to us today and in the fight for this. And to Ms. Gentile, thank you for sharing your story. It's not easy to share those things and to talk about the struggles that you've had and that you've overcome and really speaking to why this is important, why everyone should be afforded this opportunity. You've been able to flourish despite the circumstances, and we really want to make it as easy as possible for everyone to flourish and for everyone to be able to do some of the amazing things that you're doing. So thank you so much for sharing your story. And again, my thanks to Ms. Dorfman for taking some time to be with us today and to express support for the bill. I'm just incredibly grateful for everyone's testimony.
Thank you, Senator Myrie. Senator Kavanaugh, is there anything that you'd like to add or?
No, I'll just add my thanks to all of you for all your testimony and to the chair today and the sponsor of this really important legislation. It's been, you know, I think our last panel here has been a terrific hearing. But thank you all.
Well, thank you, ladies. Thank you for your testimony. And at this time, I will make some closing remarks. But Senator Myrie will be the one to close us out at the hearing, as he is the sponsor of this very important legislation. So thank you once again for your testimony. I want to thank the senators and assembly members who appeared today: Senators O'Mara, Kavanaugh, Palumbo, Gallivan, Kaminsky, Biagi, Brisport, Hoylman, and Salazar, in addition to Assemblymember Cruz. And it's not customary that a member of the Assembly would testify to Senate hearing, but she is the Assembly sponsor of this critical legislation, and we thought it was important to have her here. And want to make sure we thank our incredible staff, Central Code Staff Counsel Dorothy Powell, my committee chair, committee codes counsel Noel Mendez, and Senator Myrie's chief of staff Adeline Jacquet, for their work on the, you know, compiling the testimony and putting it all together. We've heard a lot of testimony from a lot of different people, but what you heard, the resounding support for this. There may be a thought about implementation here and the thought of a tweak there, but regardless of political affiliation or your job title, all six panels were unanimous in saying that this is something that we should be doing in the state of New York. I am grateful again for the opportunity to be able to have hearings like this. And I want to thank our leader, Andrew Stewart Cousins, again, for paving the way and ensuring that we have the ability to put things on record so that all New Yorkers can see that this is a part of the public record and that we are making decisions, and again, in a deliberative fashion. An individual should not be judged by the worst thing that they may, or in Ms. Green's case, may have not done. It is important to outline in the totality of circumstances the reason why individuals commit offenses and to give them the ability to come back from them. I'll leave you with a quote, which was timely placed in the family group chat, as it were, by my dad. Quote, throughout history, it has been the inaction of those who could have acted, the indifference of those who should have known better, the silence of the voice of justice when it mattered most, that has made it possible for evil to triumph. That came from Haile Selassie. It is important for us to think about the evil in this case, in this context, the evil of not allowing someone to have a true second chance at redemption. With that being said, to close, the sponsor of this piece of legislation, very important piece of legislation, Senator Zelno Myrie.
Thank you so much, Chairman Bailey, and none of this would be possible without your leadership, your support, you marshaling the resources and ensuring that we can make this happen. So I really want to publicly express my gratitude to you for that. It is, for folks who know the process, when you are the chair of a committee, sometimes you're not as able to get engaged with significant pieces of legislation in your committee for many reasons. And you know, I really want to express my thanks that you have chosen to engage on this particular issue. I want to echo the thanks to all of the staff that you outlined, Adeline and Noel and Dorothy, and to Senate Tech Services and all of the folks making things look good in the back. I want to thank all my colleagues that have attended and have stayed and asked thoughtful questions. And that includes my friends on the other side of the aisle, who I think asked some really good questions today. And I think it's important that we have this type of discussion. You've heard all of the substance today and the reasons why we should support this. I would just encourage anyone who is grappling with whether or not you should support the Clean Slate campaign and the Clean Slate legislation, just think about the worst thing that you've ever done, the worst thing you've ever done, and imagine if at every job interview, at every housing application, every time you had to apply for school, every time you've had to leave your house, that worst thing you've ever done has hung over you and people brought it up and it forced you to do things and move in a way that you wouldn't otherwise have to move. I want you to consider that there are 2.3 million of your neighbors. These are your family, your friends, people in the community, people that you know about and people that you don't know about, that have to live with that reality every single day. And what this legislation is about is removing the barriers, allowing them to step out front, allowing them to participate in their communities, which is a benefit for all of us. And so again, I'm just grateful that we were able to have this discussion today. I look forward to pushing for the passage of this legislation. I think that we can get this done, and I'm grateful that we were able to take a step in that direction today.
And I think we're closed.